Blog Talk Radio.
Peace to the ancestors. Yes. Peace to Dr. Cornell West. Yes. Peace to the movement. Yes. We came from the bottom. Ever since they got us, we've been going through these problems. 400 years behind, and it's no promise that we gon' never actually be equal, to be honest. It's messed up how they put us in chains, kidnapped our language and changed our names. But when we speak Ebonics, then they call it a shame. They leave us with a couple options, rob or slang. Now we locked up again. How much can our skin take? We went from slaves to inmates, carrying the weight of the 50 states, working your forms. Black nannies carrying white babies in their arms. Black men sacrifice their lives in your wars, but you'll never show appreciation here at home. You treat us so damn wrong. You act like you hate my race. The police, they just beat us in the streets like an 808 base. America, when will you defend my case? It never will, cause your freedom is fake. I'm only living here cause I wanna get paid enough to round up all my family and shake.
Get up, 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 get up.
They done tore down all the PJs in my barrio. Gang units for worst case scenario. This might work, still a couple of quirks. Can't call it pancakes cause you pour some syrup. It's a whole lot bigger than a pretty new house, especially when the rodent's still running about. P. Diddy running marathons, racing dough. That's going to the school where the tax money go. Homeland Security, now there's a phenomenon. Pacifying folks by hanging Saddam. Troops still riding, still obliging. Still no Bin Laden. Tuned in waiting for the president's announcements. No 40 acres, take these 40 ounces. We ain't gonna get on the levees. Revolution televised early. Is you ready?
Why you wanna treat me so cold, America? I done gave you all that I own, America. Took me from my mama so young, America. Locked me up and gave me your name.
When you steady being forced to climb, instead of how you back, have you beat and lost your mind? Especially when you done been down for so much time. Getting up don't even really ever cross your mind. You got porn shop, gun shop, liquor store sign. SWAT team, crack fiend, unemployed line. Stay late, dollar short, trying to buy time. What we do to survive is defined as a life of crime. You can't ball, then you forced to grind. If you fall, then you cross the line. And I've been putting in work from 9 to 5 and 5 to 9. This phone call cost a dime. What it made me is one of the relevant, highly intelligent brothers not only dealing with the same drug selling. If I'm a hustler, then what's more American? We all founded on the same thug heritage.
Why you wanna treat me so cold, America? I done gave you all that I own, America. Took me from my mama so young, America. Locked me up and gave me your name.
America, 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 you know the black freedom movement, constitution, all conscious. You know we've been trying to redeem the soul of the nation, even as that nation is trying to render us soulless. But we are our soulful people, the blues people. We've been keeping alive the blood stained banner of democracy. Thank God for those who came before. We shall never forget them and always move forward with grace and dignity.
America, why you wanna treat me so cold? America, I done gave you all that I own. America.
Welcome to another installment of Dr. Mary Lee Live. Tonight's topic, Clutch the World. Dr. Mary Lee's forum was started by herself and her co-host, Dr. James Cannon, about 3 years ago to provide a forum for us to discuss the contemporary topics of our day. Dr. Lee is the founder of the Neighborhood Commerce Institute, a nationwide organization dedicated to community organizing to unlocking the spirit of entrepreneurship, especially in the black community, and providing grant writing services to those in need. Dr. Cannon is the father of entertainer Nick Cannon and the founder of the 400 Years of African American Entrepreneurial Spirit Commission. Dr. Cannon is also the president of the Nick Cannon Foundation, and he lives his passion of inspiring the calling of the everyday individual. Dr. Lee is also joined by the panel of doctors, to include Dr. Moncrease, Dr. Anita Moncrease, Dr. Curtis Longs, and Dr. Don J. Horakhty Tynes. Without further ado, Dr. Cannon is with us tonight, so I'm going to be handing it over to him. Over to you, Dr. Cannon.
My brother, I appreciate you so very much. Can you hear me?
Yes, sir, I can hear you.
Can you hear me? Good. I appreciate you so very much. You do such an outstanding job. I appreciate everything that you bring and everything that we're going to do together, continuing in the future. I want to greet the audience tonight and say thank you very much for tuning in tonight, everybody. You know, we've got some exciting conversation. You know, one thing in listening to the music that we play every week, the America song, as we talk about 400 years of greatness, I'm the founder of the 400 Year of Greatness, in which we partnered with the 400 Year Commission, where they made my son Nick Cannon the national ambassador for the 400 years of greatness. And we published some books, and we've done up to 200 shows on 400 years of entrepreneurship, 400 years of business and due process, 400 years of life. We've talked about everything on this show, ladies and gentlemen, from the pandemic to whether or not we should be called black, Negro, or Afro-American. But one thing was pointed out in that song that we play America every week is that they locked us up and they gave us their name. And so therefore many of us as Afro-Americans, Negroes, blacks in America, old and young, we find ourselves languishing throughout this nation. And many of us don't realize what our ancestors have went through to make it possible for us to be here today. And we don't, a lot of times we don't realize who we really are. We don't realize our greatness and our strengths. And so that's the reason we've done these shows week after week with Dr. Mary Lee. And we're going to do some great stuff. We got some more new shows coming. We want to go live with video. We want to go in the clubhouse with the synergies that we've already created. And we want to make some stuff go viral on purpose, ladies and gentlemen. So those of you that's been listening and those of you that wanted to bark out on your own show, we'll start you with a radio show like this. We'll go into the video component, the live on video. Then we'll go into the clubhouse. But we want to dominate, ladies and gentlemen. Time for us as a people to brush off all the great ideals that we have stored away. And it's time for us to take those ideals and believe in those ideals and talk about them every day and make them come to pass, ladies and gentlemen. We now have the tools. Booker T. Washington said that we should pull ourselves up by our own bootstraps. Many people got offended because they said we have no bootstraps. But now, ladies and gentlemen, we do have bootstraps, and we got to use the tools that we have. And Dr. Mary Lee, you've done such an outstanding job bringing us great content week after week, great speakers week after week. And you've moderated such an outstanding way. I can't wait to see as we go live where people can see us and see who we are. And we'll go live in that format all across the nation. I just say let's go in with the mindset to dominate those new areas, not just to participate in them, because we've done such a great job here. And because of what we've done together as a team in these 3 years, I think, y'all, we're more ready. We're more prepared. And so I just want to say I appreciate everybody that's come week after week. And so as we look at the fact, as we turn the show over to Dr. Mary Lee, she brings in her guests, and I appreciate all the panel. when we look at the fact that there's a lot of us that know the story, and a lot of us have got caught up and trapped as men, we've watched our fathers and grandfathers get caught up on heroin, we watched them get caught up on crack and PCP and all different types of drugs they brought into our community to destroy our communities. And many of our young men have spent many years in the prison systems that have locked them up for years and stole their time, stole their youth. But because we have formats like this, we can come together and we can talk about best practices and things that we have learned. You know, the old saying goes, iron sharpens iron. And none of us is good as all of us. What we cannot accomplish alone, we can accomplish them together. And so I'm saying let's produce some more radio shows, y'all. I've got 8 books on Amazon, and I'm having fun pushing my books over the internet, and I want y'all to write some books too. I want y'all to get some books up on Amazon as well, and I say let's do it together. And let's produce some more shows like this and learn from Dr. Mary Lee, y'all. Pick her brain and get everything you can because she's a leader and she's doing it. And so, Dr. Mary Lee, again, I want to say I appreciate you so much. I love you so much. And I'm saying as we get into this conversation, let's go all the way down. Let's ask a hard question. And I appreciate the brother that's coming in as our guest from California. We welcome you, my brother. But we want to have some real good dialogue where we can, like the Bible says, reason together. Let's come together and reason together. Dr. Mary Lee Lai, welcome you tonight to your show.
Thank you. Thank you so much. I appreciate you so, and I thank you. I love you. Love you. Love you very much. Thank you, Garrett, for your opening. And I want all of you to know that I certainly appreciate you. Thank you for joining us and following us week after week after week after week. Without you, we would not be here. So we appreciate you all, and particularly our techs in the background, everyone who helps to make this a reality. I love you, and I thank you so much. Excited about tonight, excited about where we are, and where we're going to, as Dr. Kenneth says, we are moving forward. We are moving forward. And soon we will be live as far as your video. And it's been a journey, and it's been one that I have enjoyed, and I'm still yet enjoying, and I'm thankful, and I am very, very grateful for everyone, absolutely everyone. Tonight we do have, I want to remind you to please tap 1 on your phone. To join the conversations, we are live. We don't have any scripts. Just sitting around in the living room having a conversation. So tap 1 on your phone when you want to speak or have a question. And I want to also ask you to please mute your phone if you're not speaking. And we're going to ask Dr. Moncrease.
Can I just say something real quickly before you bring him in?
Yes, go ahead.
I just want to say to all of the people, I mean, as we go video, we just get better. You know, we get to smile a little bit more. It's been such a pleasure. Really, it has been, you know, people like Dr. Chimes, you at times I've never, you know, I wouldn't, if we passed each other in the grocery store, I don't think I would know you, sir. But you've impressed me so much week after week, you know, as well as the other panels week after week that come on. I think the panel that you bring week to week is really second to none. I think we need to go live. I think we will dominate. I think people will love us and appreciate us. We haven't been easy with each other. A lot of we wrestle with each other week after week. You know, we haven't been able to see each other. Now, when we go live on video, y'all, just let's bring our best game to the table. Just keep doing what we've always done. And I think we're going to go viral quickly, and people are going to love us. And then as we monetize what we're doing, that way we make it make sense financially for everybody. But we're learning this game together. Nobody's mastered it. But I think with the panel of team, the team that you've got, Dr. Lee, week after week, second to none. I think people are waiting to see us, our smiles, and really receive the wisdom that we have. We have over 150 shows going into YouTube that's already going to lead the way. So people will have already heard us. Now they're ready to see us. And that's what it gets exciting. Dr. Lee.
Thank you. Thank you. Yes, everyone, our shows are now. You can now go to Dr. Mary Lee Live on YouTube and, listen to any of our shows that we have since the very beginning on Dr. Mary Lee Live on YouTube, as well as Neighborhood Commerce Institute. So we've got them all posted up now. And, yes, I'm looking forward to, going video where we can all be seeing this. This is a journey, and I'm willing to go all the way. So it's all new still.
Absolutely.
Yet, but I'm just excited about what we're doing. And you all, we're here for you, and we're here to talk about the difficult topics. So we're going to ask our guest tonight is Mr. Marshon Kincy. And again, I'm going to ask to mute your phone because you're not speaking. We've got some background noise here. So I think we're going to start with our guest panelists who are with us each and every week. Just to introduce yourself, say who you are, and you can also comment on what we've been talking about most recently, and we started with Dr. Moncrease.
Hello, good evening, and again, it's a pleasure to be here. I appreciate the opportunity to come on and share my thoughts and my views on our selected topics. I've grown and learned so much over the past 2 years, and so I really appreciate each and every one of you on the panel, and I really appreciate the audience, and I love our host. Tonight's show I'm looking forward to. I had a phone call today from a person who's an inmate in federal prison that I've been working with, and I didn't realize it'd been 4 years until she told me today this is 4 years. She's a physician, a graduate of a medical school who did not do as well as she thought, as well as she could on an examination that all the doctors have to take in order to get their license, and that just started her spiraling to a situation that ended up with her being incarcerated. She finally got her license, but some of the things that she did while she was working toward that license had her end up in prison. And so now she can never practice medicine again once she gets out. But I'll share some more of that story tonight if we have time. But I'm looking forward to hearing our guest, special guest speaker tonight, so that it can help put in perspective some of the things that our young people go through, and some of the mistakes and challenges that they make along the way. That really, a lot of our young people who are incarcerated are really no different than those who are outside. If they had been white, they'd got a little slap on the wrist and been able to go forward and do their thing. But because they weren't white and they didn't have the resources, they end up part of this permanent system. So even when they come out, the opportunities aren't really there. But that's all I'm going to say on that. I'm Dr. Anita Moncrease. My background is internal medicine and pediatrics. And I'm just looking forward to tonight's show. Thank you.
And thank you, Dr. Moncrease. Certainly, you've just contributed so very much, you know, and we're just beginning. We're just beginning. Dr. Tynes, you would introduce yourself and tell a little bit about who you are and what we talk about.
Okay. Hi. Hope you can hear me.
We can hear you.
Okay. You know, it's an honor, privilege to be a part of the program, to listen, to learn. I'm looking forward to this gentleman who had to go see the homeless route. You know, I'm currently trying to rehab a building to make it a homeless boys shelter. From ages 12 to maybe 18 or 17, to give the kids a chance who are not allowed to go into the adult men's shelter. You know, I've had some economic hard times, so I know what it is to not have enough money and have to try to sleep in a car and stuff, and then to overcome. And then what I've learned is that those who have a little bit more finances can finance more justice than broke justice. So there's two types of justice. There's broke justice, and then there's finance justice. Finance justice means that you get enough of a lawyer who can treat you as though you're black, but you get the same judgment that a white person would get. And poor justice is just us. And we just poor, and that means we got to do time, we got to do warrants and all those type of things. So the system sets it up in a spiraling cycle where you're unemployed, so they add more debt to you, and then because you weren't able to pay, then they had to add more debt to you to guarantee that you stay with slavery. And people don't realize that the whole jail prison system was a direct response to the Emancipation Proclamation. That's when you had the formation of jails and prisons to enslave the blacks that just got released out of slavery. So that mentality and that system is still in place today. So I look forward to hearing how the young man overcome those challenges. Thank you.
And thank you. Thank you. Dr. Long, welcome tonight.
Thank you.
You are. All righty.
Again, okay. I want to say hello to everyone, particularly to our guest speaker tonight, Mr. Marshon Kincy. I'm Dr. Curtis Longs. I'm a physician. I practice in the field of psychiatry and neurology. Most of my time is in the forensic environment, known as a juvenile detention facility. And on a daily basis, I'm encountering young men who haven't had the guidance from kindergarten on up, and subsequently they've landed in a system in which they seem to struggle with staying out of. And I emphasize that, and the reason I emphasize that is I would say since I've been downtown in Detroit in the juvenile detention facility, our recidivism is probably at 85%. And I'm always interested and curious in trying to learn as to how that can be prevented. And I will say that a lot of our young people really, really try to survive in this system, but a lot of them just don't realize how things are stacked against them. And even in residential treatments, in which a lot of people go as a court order, the recidivism rate subsequently still hasn't gone down. So I'm looking forward to the guest speaker tonight, and hopefully I can add to his discussion as it relates to talking some reality regarding this the injustice of this justice system. Thank you, Dr. Mary Lee. Thank you, Dr. Cannon. Thank all of my colleagues, as well as all of our other panelists who have worked so hard throughout these past 3 years. Thank you.
And thank you, and thank all of you. I'm just grateful, just grateful. Mr. Marshon Kincy, thank you for joining us. I'm going to read an article. This has been, and you can tell us, Mr. Kincy, when this was written. I believe it was sometime, you know, in the maybe early 2000s somewhere. But it says, a year ago, 23-year-old Marshon Kincy's life was far simpler. He was working for the Census Bureau, and along with his girlfriend was raising their infant daughter, Malaysia. After he spent 5 days in jail for an old ticket for riding the subway without paying, his girlfriend returned to Belize, and things began falling apart. Kincy had depended in part on her income, and without it, the newly single parent and his daughter were left homeless. Me and my daughter, quote, me and my daughter would sleep in my car and go to friends' houses, Kincy said. While he was without a roof, Kincy's problems compounded. He said he lost his job and didn't pay the fines that were in that were a condition of his release from jail. So two more warrants were issued for his arrest. Have you heard about Los Angeles County experimental homeless court program after he and his daughter were accepted into a Santa Monica transitional housing program in December? By participating in the court program, he said he's now on the road to repairing his life and moving forward. Last month, Kincy was among 39 homeless defendants who had charges dismissed by the Superior Court Judge, Michael Tynes, who has presided over all five sessions of the court that began a year ago. Tynes dismissed his warrants for minor quality of life criminal offenses, such as sleeping in public, illegal use of a shopping cart, jaywalking, if offenders meet certain criteria. Each must be continuously involved in a rehabilitative program for at least 90 days. Defendants also must have no criminal citations for 6 months. All offenses have to be occurred in Los Angeles County, and felonies and serious misdemeanors are exempt. No crimes involving a victim, a weapon, or drug possession or sales are allowed. We get the prosecutors to agree to dismiss the warrants since there's no money here, Tynes said. We get about 20 or 30 defendants together. Then we have a ceremony at the shelter. Since the court inception, at least about 100 people have gone before Tynes, said Lisa, who assists in coordinating the court. Because the program is in its infancy, all the kinks haven't been worked out. Direction attorney at the public counsel stated, a public interest law firm. For one thing, the court keeps no records that chart whether those whose cases have been dismissed have been able to stay out of further trouble. So welcome, 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 Mr. Kincy. And then it goes on to say more. But, you know, we welcome you. We're excited, very excited to hear you tell your story, your life story, and where you are today. I want to say to our listening audience and to everyone that Mr. Kincy is involved and has created and just an unbelievable amount of projects for entrepreneurs and the programs on top of programs on top of programs that have been established to just help so many people. So I want to welcome you. I want you to tell your story. Tell us, how you got to where you are, what you're doing, and what you would say to many others, or what you do say actually, to young people, you know, coming from, you know, coming from the streets, coming from very bad situations. Welcome, Mr. Marshon Kincy. The floor is yours.
Thank you. Thank you so much. Thanks, everybody. I'm glad to be invited here. I'm excited about, you know, having this conversation. It's kind of like, for me, it's my rookie year. After coming from, you know, the things that I've been through from 2002, you know, I was dating someone, and she kind of took off and left me with a child, in a sense, pretty much. And so, you know, she was 9 months when my daughter was 9 months when she left. So she was breastfed. So it began right away because she was a breastfed baby for 9 months. So I remember having to put hot water, warm water in a balloon and tie it up and then give it to her hand and sneak the bottle in her mouth to make her think it was a breast to get her used to eating from a bottle, drinking from a bottle. So that was kind of like my first experience of having that set in place in there. It was kind of one of those things where she had left the daughter, well, my daughter with her cousin, and that cousin was kind of like, you got to come get your baby or we're going to call DPSS. So I had to go snatch her, just go do what I had to do. And, you know, when you're driving around and you're kind of homeless at the time now, and it's kind of like, you know, I was able to get into a shelter. And I think that's where everything kind of systematically changed, because in this time, talking about like 2000, there was no single man fathers kind of too much. So most shelters had all woman shelters. So when I went to Upward Bound, the shelter was mainly maybe 21 women, and I was only male there in there. And so every Tuesday, Thursday, they would have these meetings that they would talk about. And of course, being only male there and being like 21 women in the shelter there, all with their kids and all with their families, everybody would tell their story. And so as I'm sitting there as one man, I would just hear all these stories of how these women ended up in these shelters from abuse. So many things that happened, and I'm just sitting here, you know. And, you know, I'm from Compton, California, so I've seen things and I saw things, but this was another level for me. You know, I'm 23 years old. I'm fresh into the world. I'm trying to be a father, and it's just like seeing these stories and these things, I think that set me in a different trajectory, in a sense, as far as what I wanted to do and what I wanted to have from hearing these stories, you know. From that, I went 7 years asking it. It was so compelling what happened to me. And the stories that I felt, that it was impossible for me to come out there and kind of, you know, talk to women or really date women in the sense of that nature, coming from what I had been through. I felt like as a man, there was a lot of work I had to do on myself, you know. And so, you know, it was, you know, for me, sleeping in the car was with my daughter was, in a sense, it was hard because, you know, you didn't have a fridge or anything, so peanut butter and jelly sandwich was pretty much key. The beaches were the best place to get hot water, so you could take a beach 2 o'clock in the morning, 3 o'clock in the morning with nobody there, hot water for a beach, you know. If I wanted to give my daughter a bath somewhere during the day, I would just spill some. I'll go to my cousin's house, spill something on there, and they allow me to take a bath or something, so I wouldn't let nobody know, because at that time, I felt kind of ashamed to be homeless. I didn't know about AFDC. I didn't know about food stamps. I didn't know that I could get help, you know. I didn't find out until I got into the shelter, you know. And from that part, you know, it kind of blessed me, allowed me to get into the Section 8 program. And from that part, I started to get into more economic development and really started to go into youth and, you know, opened the Cluster World Center in Long Beach, which Fox News came out. And Fox News, if you can find a video on Fox News, on the Cluster World building we did in Long Beach. So that just began a real economic change for me. And, you know, it's a long road from that time, but I feel now I have pretty much found the place that we need and can prepare some things from what I've been through to really think we can elevate our people to the place I think we need to get to.
Thank you. Thank you. You have created an organization which is named Clutch the World. Tell us about Clutch the World. This is in Compton, and
yeah, Clutch the World is an organization.
Yeah,
Clutch the World is an organization because, yeah. It's kind of like, you know how you say reach out and touch somebody? Well, I wanted to reach out and clutch, you know what I'm saying, reach out and hold on, because in our community, we don't need to just kind of go out there and just kind of reach out and touch our youth, give them an ideal, give them a nice business, but we've kind of got to clutch and hold on to them, you know. In our community, we kind of have a facet to where we are mimicked a lot. With all due respect, we can't really create without everybody creating what we create. And so it's very hard for us to kind of get a foot in the door on something because we're not able to kind of get the leverage that everyone else gets when it comes to our culture. Our culture is kind of shared with everybody, and everybody else kind of can hold their culture to themselves. And because of that, you know, we have to find a way, an element to be able to control that for our youth and for the and for our, you know, the generation that's coming. So Clutch the World is an organization that wants to be able to bring a lot of these organizations in, but we have a stronghold with our organizations to create long-term success for our black businesses. It's not that we can't do it. We have done it many times before. I think blacks have forgot that it's been destroyed. It was bombed. Every time we've done it, it's been bombed. It's not as if, you know, we say we need to unite. We've done it before. I think people don't understand in 1920 when they instituted 1920, they implemented the prohibition. They have to understand, as soon as they implemented prohibition, they started bombing Tulsa, Oklahoma. They started bombing all the black communities as soon as prohibition was implemented. So what does that tell you? As soon as he sobered up, he started bombing all the black communities. So when we say, oh, we need to do it, we did it. They bombed it. We did it in the 80s. They redlined us. So it's like every move we make, there's another move that hurts that. So we've got to kind of clutch and hold on so that we won't get redlined, we won't get kind of bond with our communities. It's too much that has happened as we unify and get it together that has been taken away from us because everybody kind of, in a sense, feels the need to want to get a piece of our culture for their financial gain. And that's the main personal problem that we have, with all due respect.
Thank you. So I really liked that. I was really was, and you answered my question. You know, how you got to the name Clutch, you know, Clutch the World. And so I certainly understand you have quite a large number of initiatives and success. Who are the people? I know that your program deals with, it deals with poverty, of course, homelessness, racism, immigration, economics, that you deal a lot with legislation, proposals, media campaigns, and events. So you're doing an awful lot, and you have definitely made a mark in Compton. Tell us a little bit, you know, about these programs and the participants. I know you've worked with gang members, and I just want to hear particularly what's going on, you know, with the Bloods and the Crips, and how you got started, you know with the, you know, working with the gangs, and the outcomes, you know, what are some of your outcomes, and what are you planning? You know, where are some of the people that you work with?
Well, what we're doing is I've just kind of been around a lot as far as in the communities, really bringing together as many organizations and black organizations who are about bringing together our people. So when you talk about peace in the hood, when you talk about the diaspora, when you talk about the FAU, when you talk about the Mighty Forefront, when you talk about the Six Regions, when you talk about the black elders, the Queen Mother's Coalition, you know, so we work with all these organizations pretty much that have pretty much been moving forward in the community. And what we're doing now is kind of, in a sense, merging these organizations and everybody that has put in this work into a format where we can create so that we have this clutch hold on our youth, on our culture, and the financial economics we need to kind of hold. So for us, majorly, it's a lot of organizations because everybody's like, we do it united. And it doesn't take unity to do it in a sense, you know. In a sense, it's kind of like, you know, when the ants go and they hunt, one grabs a leg, You got the other ant that sprays. You got one ant that chops. Mm-hmm. Everybody has a certain position that everybody can just do their position in a sense. The problem we have in our community is that the guy that's spraying the acid gets more attention than the guy that's holding the leg, so the guy let the leg go because he wants to be the acid sprayer. And it's like, you know, everybody's not made to do the same thing. We all can't do the same thing. We have to spread ourselves throughout so that we have the doctors and the lawyers at the same level as our athletes and our celebrities. You know, we need to be able to create this atmosphere and our culture to where we are kind of out front. It's very easy to start a business stuff, but if we don't have an outlet to get that business to the people, if we don't own a network, if we don't own commercials, if we can't get that. I mean, if I start a business stuff, I got to go pay them to get my commercial out there. And that's forced upon us in the country that we built, in the country that we died on, that they hung us by the millions. We can't even get our own network. And so when you look at those aspects, you have to say, well, why? And I think that's the question that we have to look at of why. You know, after 400 years, there's a black-owned businesses that has the power level or the reach that when I say a household name like Coca-Cola, it's just a black-owned business. Now, I know there's a lot of black-owned businesses, but if I could, I could say Coca-Cola anywhere in the world, anybody knows exactly what that means. I can't do it for a black-owned business. 400 years being here. So is that because something's wrong with us? No, it's by design. So we have to fix that problem as a united force. Because the problem that we see in our communities is I hear so much, oh, well, blacks are killing blacks. Blacks kill blacks. And so that gives everybody excuse. Well, why are blacks complaining about blacks killing blacks? So when the white man kills you, when the police kill you, you get mad and complain because you're killing each other. Well, wait a minute. Let's back this up a little bit. Because if you go back to everybody's country who's saying that, they're killing each other too. What's the difference from what you're doing in your country that we're doing here? Oh, I know the difference. You have an America to come to. See, I was born in Compton where they was busting and shooting. I was just thinking the other day, laughing, and we was used to laugh because we would run on top of Tibby Elementary School, and we used to laugh at the dudes trying to shoot us, driving around like, they ain't gonna get us, they ain't gonna get us. And I'm like, man, that was horrible. We didn't even know what we was doing, you know? But my mom didn't have an America to take us to. She didn't have a place to say, come on, I'm going to take you to a better place. We had to fight. And I see what people don't think is when you talk about unity, we are the only ones who had no choice but to fight our government knuckle up with our fists. Everybody else had an opportunity to come to America. So when their government got out of control, just like King George did, when King George got it out of control, what they do, they fled. So when this government got control, it was hanging us. It was boom. They killed, we trying to get out, you know, but Harriet Tubman trying to get, they killed her. So we had no way to fight now. Can't get out the country, so all we had to do was go all our bloody stomachs. They forget about our bloody stomachs. All our bloody stomachs we had. All the deaths and all the marches we had to die for to get what we had to get to the place that we had to get to. Nobody else did that to their country. Everybody fled here. And so what are you talking about what we did when you fled? We had to fight. And fight and fight and fight civil rights dogs. Go look at Eyes on the Prize. Where were you with Eyes on the Prize? But at the end of the day, we got to take that punishment, right? All that heat and all that punishment because we the ones that's killing each other because we don't handle with the free. We the only ones who fought and we won. We won freedom. We won civil rights. We won knuckling up with the most powerful country in the world. 1960s, they had weapons of mass destruction. We had to fight them with our fists. When everybody else had a government that was beating on them, that wasn't even hanging them and doing nearly what they were doing to us, they ran. And there's no disrespect at all. But he said, why are you talking about my people as if we're doing something that your people haven't done? Tell me what's different from gangbanging and cowboying. What's the difference from riding up in a posse on the back of a horse, busting on somebody, and doing it 100 years later in a car? But you learned how to get gas, and you learned about gold and oil, and you change your ways. So my people should change their ways too. It is not as if we have done something that nobody else has done. We just didn't have an America that we built. We just didn't really get a chance to enjoy it. With all due respect, we didn't really get a chance to enjoy it. We don't have a father home or a mother home. This was it. When they snatched us from there, from the motherland, this was it. Now, we know the story of the indigenous Americans that were here. We get that, too. So this is where we get into racism at, because that's racism. And what has happened is we have allowed everybody else to use a word like racism. That is our word. It's as if you could never be anti-Semitic to you. I could never be anti-Semitic to you because there's a reason why. We know the reason why. So if black people have never hugged you, they have never beat your people, do you know what it took for a black girl to keep her virgin in the 1700s? Or ask, do you think black girls made it to virginity at 13, 14, 15 years old? There were 18-year-old black virgins walking around in the 1800s, the 1700s, early 1800s? Never had that happen to you. But when somebody say, you go back to your country, that is the word racism. How is that? How do we allow the UN to define racism when they never been slaves? So what has happened is they have continued to allow people to use this word that they have not earned. There is discrimination and there is prejudice. But they're not getting hung at the border right now. They're not getting sold at the border right now. If they were getting sold at the border, you can say, this is racist what's going on here. Because that's what they did to the blacks. We are what racism is. This is between us and white people. Nobody else should be in this conversation. And the problem is we have too many people in the conversation. So we can never get away from it because even though they have never hung all these people, they have never beat them people, have never sold all them people, they can come here and say, oh, I don't like the way you speak your language. Oh, you're being racist to me. And now the word that we have to die and hung on trees for the million is used for a benign, I'll say it with all due respect, a benign reason compared to what my people use it for. And so everybody is a citizen here. But like I tell the people, what has to happen is we as black people have to step up and we have to understand, yes, you are a citizen here, but we're a little different. So we are what we call purple heart citizens. You know when you're in the veterans and you get a purple heart, that means you've done a little, you've been through a little bit more. Nothing personal, just, you know, you will hold your hand when you see them up for like 2 or 3 seconds more, like, okay, I'm going to hold it 3 seconds more for that purple star vet. For that one who got, he was hung on trees, and he still created music. He still created pop and Motown. He still kept it pushing and kept moving forward with all the, everything that was up against him. Even though he was getting booed and beaten to be a baseball player, he still played baseball. So they accepted him. Everything we fought for. And everybody benefits from it except us. The number one in homelessness, the number one employment. Nobody rent to us, nobody employment, but everybody got a coalition with us. How does that work? How? But I digress. I'm sorry. Any questions? I didn't want to go too much into tangent. I apologize.
Oh, no. The floor is yours. Absolutely.
Dr. Lee.
Any questions? Yes. Go ahead.
Dr. Lee, I'd like to support my brother. This is Dr. Tynes. So, one, what is good is that he now is showing what we spoke before, that when you know your history, you know your greatness and how important that is, and also for unification. And the middle class Negro, the house Negro, the educated Negro is the one who don't want to deal with our correct history so that we have a correct reality. So we have to get the record straight. Coming over in change is not the same thing as coming over with a visa or a passport. When you come over with a visa and a passport, as you know by your baby mama, you have options to leave or to stay. The African didn't have that. The next thing is that the African is still, and as of the, August 17th of 2022, is still not a citizen of the United States, according to the Supreme Court Dred Scott decision, as well as the Constitution stating that he is not a full human being, and that's why the movement of Malcolm X was for human rights in the last 2 years of Martin Luther King movement was for human rights as well, and they gave up on the civil rights. And he's also important that he says in terms of the first people in the United States were called the Fulson, F-O-L-S-O-N, and they were African, and they are the one of the founding population that gave us what we call the Native people or the Native American. And that what's important is that he talks about the different groups. The 1866 treaty was a treaty, the Indian Treaty, where the Native Americans, 5 civilized tribes, who allowed whites into them if they paid $5 to become part of the 5 civilized tribes, those white Indians still owe the African reparations. And what's important that the brother, be pointing to is that, number one, is that all the way up until the Emancipation Proclamation, after that the we had not lost who we were. We were still calling ourselves Africans, and we were called for. And in 1865, the Emancipation Proclamation, they created prisons. The last point that you said is correct, is that what Dr. Claude Anderson teaches us is that, one, that racism that was created to actually to talk about the race to the new world and to use the African as the collateral base. And we have made every race on the face of the earth rich but ourselves. So he's absolutely correct there. And that we are the only group that is discouraged from working with ourselves only, and that everybody else wants to exploit us but not help us. And so what he's saying is that it's all about us, and we have to focus on us. So we got to clutch on and hold on to us and stop allowing others to come in and divide us. We have to clutch on to those who are for real. We don't try to make people black or not black. We don't try to grab a young lady from India who got an aristocratic dad from Jamaica and try to make her a soul sister. We don't do that. We don't try to take Eminem, a European American, and try to make him a black American. So we have to stop the nonsense and focus on us. You know, we got to do like the Nipsey Hussle and make sure that we invest in ourselves and start loving ourselves. And I think that all the gentlemen like myself and others, that we have to listen to this. But the core of it is he dropped the knowledge and the science that the black middle class rejects, that the educated class rejects. And I think that should be the criteria and the yardstick that we use when you're going out there trying to work with individuals. If individuals have a problem with learning their correct history, then they're going to be a problem down the road, because those are the ones who've been brainwashed and trained and going to be the ones who are going to be the Al Sharptons and the Jesse Jacksons to be your FBI informants that turn on you later down the road. So I think he's been successful because he's been getting brothers and sisters who are in with the conscious movement or the African-centered movement or the cultural movement, and like meaning like. And what Dr. Shiraz Ali says is that we need unity, not uniformity. We need unity, not uniformity. And what Dr. Francis Craig Felder says, that we have to focus on ourselves because they see us as a threat to their annihilation, because we are the dominant genetic makeup, that a drop of our blood or genetic DNA will turn any race black. So it's us against them and with them. And the last point, if he listened to this point that he made out, every single movement, every single bill, every single legislation always has a hidden agenda. The civil rights movement was written by whites, not by King, not by black. And what it did, it was dilute the efforts of the Africans at that time, the descendants of enslaved Africans, by including white women who were part of the rock throwing and trying to beat up the blacks, and included Native Americans who were off the scene not doing anything, who still owe reparations and are still discriminating against the African American. And it also at that time brought in the mainland Hispanic Puerto Ricans who had not contributed and fought in the civil rights but died in the civil rights, but diluted that effort, and also made the white woman the number one minority in the United States, so that minority businesses, 85% of them go to the white women. So this young brother is aware of that, and that's what we have to see, that when you have this awareness and you have that focus, then the people are hungry to hear this, and they're listening to his message, and they're using the Dr. Ben, the Dr. John Henry Clark, the A.C. Hilliard, and all of this too, and Leonard Jeffries. These are what the kids are looking for and listening for, and I think that we have to recognize the power behind our history. Thank you.
And thank you. Marshon, you want to respond?
Yes, he's absolutely right. I think we, as far as when it comes to the youth, we really have to get our youth to understand. You know, there was hood, then there was ghetto, and then there was urban. Now, we know what hood is. Nobody want to be hood. You know what I'm saying? You know what ghetto is. We know what ghetto was, you know. And so then there was urban. And see, and that's the most important key aspect of things, is when you look at the word urban. Because, see, as a black man, I could never be suburban. Go be suburban. You see, it's only a one-way thing. When it comes to all these other races, it's only one way. Everybody is urban. They can come and be black, because when you say urban, it's black. And see, what has happened now is the word spaz. You can't use the word spaz because now the word spaz means retarded. But where was that dictated at in our culture? Because we speak Ebonics. So the word smoke could mean 100 different things in the black community. So why are we have allowed these people to be urban to now they're checking us on words? We've never, ever used cowabunga. When back in the 90s when girls used to say like if you watch the like and dude, we never took those words. Essay and vato, we never took those words. That was their stuff. But our kids now can't even go to junior high school without every kid calling them a nigga now. Nigga. They call the every kid. So, like, that's just crazy. And, just, and everybody's saying nigga. I feel like, you know, and it's like our kids are now dealing with what we dealt with in the 1800s. Nigga, it's just a cultural urban thing. It's not fair. Why are our kids having to hear this word on a consistent basis from everybody? They talked about us when we were sagging. They made songs about black people sagging. They don't talk about sagging no more. Why? Because everybody's sag. Go look. Go look and see everybody's sagging now. But when we did it, oh, you monkeys. Look at these stupid dumpies. They sagging. When our black women had colored hair, oh, they so ghetto with that color hair. Now everybody got, oh, they goth. Oh, that's just cool. That's the color hair. It's all cool now. It ain't ghetto no more. So it's always what we do with ghetto until they able to do it. And then once they able to do it, it's cool. You see, the thing that happens is coaching, we are affected economically because a lot of times, like, our black women, we know why our black women. I woke up one day, it's about 5:30. My cousin don't have to be to work tonight. I'm like, why are you up? She's like, I'm doing my hair. I got to get my hair brand new, my hair. I'm like, man, you know. So I understand why black women wear wigs. So when you look at it economically, you say, okay, well, I know why black women wear wigs. Why everybody else wear wigs, I really don't know. But, okay, that's not for me. You know, it's not my business. I get it. There's other reasons. But the key aspect is when you have black women wearing wigs and you know why you have a need to get up to go to work, throw a wig on, and be in work an hour is perfect, and to sit there and take time doing your hair, I understand it 100%. So if wigs are $200 and 1 million black women are buying wigs, those wigs are $200. But what happens when this person start buying wigs, this race, and this race, and this race, and this race, those wigs go to $600-$700 now. So now, and that happens pretty much in everything black people find enjoyable or that we like to do. There's nothing we can create that comes from our culture. You don't have to go buy from somebody else. Nobody would never. When we came out with Cars Ride By with the booming system, that means the audio market for cars blew up, right? So that means the market go up. Now, you'll see by the time we even started getting our auto stores up, everybody else did it too. Okay, fine. What about throwback jerseys? The same thing. Come for our coach, we talk about throwback jerseys. Next thing you know, everybody's selling throwback jerseys. Okay. All right, same thing with the real market. We come to hip hop, the real, 20 is real. Everybody's selling the real market. Like, okay, how can we need to get manufactured distribution, and it takes months to set that up. But see, everybody else has whole countries that they can go to, get distribution, get manufactured, and get it out in a month. So for us to build that manufacturing and get our rims and get this set, because other than that, we have to go buy it for them. And if we go buy it for them, what they going to do? They're going to charge us more than they're going to charge their people, which is only right. It's only right. It's good. I'm going to charge my black person cheaper than I'm going to charge somebody else. I get it. I'm not mad about that. But why are you doing it in our culture? Why are you doing it in something that we create? We don't touch other people being like that. We don't go out and do that with our chata. That market and make it big and go out there and say, oh, this is the market. We finna go and milk and take the market back. But they'll go and take our culture, our DJs. They'll take rapping. They'll take anything that we have. People say, well, rap is supposed to be not just our culture. Our kids, we can't even be. If you look at radio stations, and I put Latino radio station, Asian radio station, pop radio station right here, country radio station, and I put a hip-hop radio station. When it comes to the Asian, 90% of that people probably be all Asians coming to be a DJ for that radio station. It'll be the same for the Latinos. It'll be the same for whites. But when it's the hip-hop radio station, you got Asians, you got Latinos. Our kids have to compete with the whole world in their culture, and there's something wrong with that. Because we can't get the jobs because we have to compete with everybody. And it's nothing personal, but it's like, where do we go eat at? I get it, but where can we go eat at? Just tell us where we can go eat, where you will come buy it from us. Because you never came into our barbershop, you wouldn't open your own barbershops. So where can we go and eat for us? Because see, society makes it harder for us. See, for my black woman to become a beautician, she got to go to school. She got to learn about these chemicals. But somebody else can come from another country, and they can literally sell the same chemicals that she got to go to school for. She literally can sell it off the shelf to many people without knowing what it is. Don't even know how to say it. Don't even know how to use it. They selling perm kits all in all these places. But our women got to go to school and pay money to learn how to do this, and they can just come open up a business and sell the same thing she go to school and learn for. How is that? Why is that? How does that happen in our country that we were hung on? And then when you say there's something wrong with it, it's nothing wrong with it. I just want to know, because y'all keep saying black people kill each other. Y'all keep talking about, so it's like, keep my people's name out your mouth. With all due respect, y'all don't have the right to talk about black people. Why? Because we copied our government. With all due respect, yeah, when your government was treating you the way he was treating you, you fled. Okay, that's fine, but don't come tell us how to economically grow.
Dr. Lee, can I jump in real quick and ask a question?
Okay, go ahead.
Beautiful young man, that's powerful young man. You're a powerful young man, brother. Right from the beginning, from everything that you shared, you know, from your struggle in, you know, being a single father with your daughter, man, I commend you. I want to write some books with you. I want to do some shows with you. If you already, tell us where you, we can hear you weekly, because you got some passions and you stir up some stuff. If you're not being heard weekly, young man, we want to encourage you that you need to be heard weekly, and we want to help produce that and put that out. But one question I want to ask you, because I it sounds like you have a clear understanding of things. My question would be, speak to the young men between 13 and 18 about their opportunities that may listen to this show. You've articulated very well the problems and what's coming against us as a people and how other people can come and get in front of us. One Jewish person explained to me, he said, Mr. Cannon, you have to pat us on the back. You have to understand it has to be clever of us as a people. If your people are not using your talent and you're not capitalizing it in the movie industry, in the sports industry, and y'all not taking advantage of it, and we figure out how to get in and make us some money and take advantage of it and take care of our people, you would have to think that's pretty clever of us. So if that's their plan, what would you say to the young men and young women, 13 to 18, that may have made some mistakes or may haven't made some mistakes? Can you just speak to our audience, those young kids with that same passion?
Yeah, you know, the key element is that, you know, we go back to urban in our culture and our society. And I say this, for instance, it's hard because if I say, if the black man come out and he comes out with, oh man, let me try to make up something that they won't take. I'm going to try to just make up something. If he comes out and he comes with glow-in-the-dark sandals, right? And so a black dude start doing glow-in-the-dark sandals, and our young men create that ideal, what's going to happen is in his country, everybody's going to start doing it. Next thing you know, it's going to be Skechers glow-in-the-dark sandals, Nike glow-in-the-dark sandals. So it's hard for him to get the respect. Because you got to remember something. In all these other countries, they all have people of color. If you go to the Latin countries, the Asian countries, they all have people of color. But those people of color in their countries live in the most poorest and the most rural, and they treat them the most horrible. With all due respect, I'm not lying. If you go and you look at these countries, the people that are dark-skinned in these countries live in the lower bottom edges of these countries. They have a different respect in their countries for dark-skinned people. So when they come to America, they have that same mindset. So it's hard for us to when they look at us as someone in there, for them to walk into a store where they see someone in their country who was beneath them, so they feel like, I can't go shop with them. That's why they never opened up barbershops. That's why our black people had to go and sell our CDs out of the trunk, because none of the stores would allow us to sell in their stores. No, we don't want your business here. Even though we're buying all the alcohol and everything from these stores, our black men have to go sell all their albums where they see these what out of their trunks, because nobody gave them distribution. But that was the messed up part, because we should have kept selling our CDs out of our trunks. Because if we kept selling CDs out of the trunks, we would have had 100% of all of our hip-hop our albums, 100% of all our music, and nobody would have got nothing. We allowed them to trick us into coming into their platforms, coming into their networks where we were already making 100% of our CD sales, print, distribution, and sales right in our course. And so we should have just got more people from the community to go out there and say, look, you sell, that's 10 cars, you go to Francis, you go to, you sell by CD, and we should have kept distribution flat out. We should have never merged. And so what I'm trying to do is get people to understand, we come, we work together. The problem is, see, when black people start building, everybody, that's, oh, that's nice, can I help? And you don't want to be mean, like, no, you know, come on, you come help, it's cool. But then when they come help and they see what you're doing, and by the time you look up, they're building the same thing over there, and you're like, oh, man, we should have never let them help us. So we've got to understand, when we build, I have to create the stuff that we're doing very small, because it's hard for me to kind of get the business done that needs to get done, because everybody feels it at our level. It's like this reparation money they're doing for California. The reparation was, what, $800 million? And all of a sudden, as it got broken down and everybody started looking at it, it went for $400 million and another $400 million for people of color. Why? Why? Why did you switch it from that? Why? What did people? Because people started to complain about us getting our money. They can't stand to see us getting this money. So all this red line money that's coming in, they go, we got to give these blacks this money for this, and we cheated blacks for this, and they want to give money. Well, what about us? Well, what about you? Nobody want to see us get anything. So every time we get money, people are moving at it. That's not fair. Well, that's how, what about us? What about us in our country, the one that we built? So we can't. So I have to tell them, like, you know, it's hard for us to get ahead, because if our young black women create a whole new brand style, if a young black woman create a whole brand style and say, I'm going to teach y'all online how to make this, how to tie this braid and come in there and start making our company, within 1 week, it'll already be wigs coming out of another country with that same hair braid style. She would lose her business in 1 second. So it's hard for us to get business ahead.
My question would be understanding that all that's happening to us, and we've been here for 400 years, we've seen all the games played on us, we know the game. You know, my son Nick did something in a comedy skit one time, and he said the things that the white people had to do to get black people over to America, they had to have a whole lot of meetings once they realized the talents and the strength. In order to establish the NFL and the NBA and control that with the talent of these talented Afro-American people, they had to have a whole lot of meetings. As I watch a lot of the other ethnic groups come into America, and I watch them have meetings in their garages on Saturday mornings, and they begin to do what our people did many years ago. Now, granted, they had a plan to divide us and send us to prison and get our kids to produce garbage music to confuse us, and they released heroin and drugs into the community. So we understand that now, 400 years, what's the solution? How do we come together on shows like this across the nation with great solutions now of how we can get ahead? Of what we can do to seize the means of production and control. If the internet is the new frontier, if we find that the new frontier is the metaverse, is cryptocurrency, then we should have our young people, and we're going to do some things where our young people are helping leading out and getting that information so we can lead and dominate in these new frontiers so we don't get left behind. I'm just saying the solution, when you don't have money, you got to utilize people until you get the money. Maybe we all need to set up foundation, family foundation, and out of that foundation, go back to your brothers and sisters in your family. Jesus said, love your enemy, bless your enemy. What about your family? Can we make up with our families to the point where some of us say, yeah, I love them, but I don't mess with them. I don't F with them. So what they're saying is, they my family, but I don't do business with them. But, y'all, we got to go back and strengthen some of the roots and see if we can do business with our brothers and sisters and cousins and with a goal in mind. Well, we say, can we set a goal as a family, a million family, black family, setting a goal to raise $1 million in 2 months where it's in the bank? Well, we say, that's what we're going to do. Whatever you're going to do with your million is up to you. Whatever you have to do to get your million, But can you go back to your family? We want to heal the community. We want to heal the city, the nation. What about your brother? Your sister? Can you call them and say, can we do this together? Can we write a book together? Because we don't have to sell it out of the trunk no more like the rappers. The rappers did learn. They were brilliant. They created an industry. But now can we create some books? I got 8 on Amazon. They have them there in 2 days. Let's pimp that system together and create a $1 million plan for the family. Because if it's in the bank in 2 months, that's your goal. And your family did that together. You brilliantly put together a plan when 2 months, you and your family, whether you got 5 in your family or 2 in your family, I'm saying let's get it done, and we come back and help each other in 2 months with a plan, and we share successes, ladies and gentlemen. We've been here too long. We know all the problems. We fought in all the wars. Now it's for us like those good Hebrew people looking down where they knew it was milk and honey flowing down there in the land. They sent spies down there. And 10 of them came back and said, we be not able. 2 of them said, listen, Joshua and Caleb, we well able. This giant, they're going to fight us. They're going to curse us. But we well able if we go up at once and take the land. Tell that to your family. Go back and read Joshua 1, where God told Joshua, you got to be very strong and courageous. But if you sanctify yourself, you'll see miracles, y'all. We are an incredible people. Brother, what you went through, what you've been going through, I want to connect with you. I love your passion, and I think we need to continue to connect. Dr. Lee, I appreciate you. I appreciate the show. Outstanding, y'all.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
Not fair to hold mentally ill people, mentally injured people to the same standard as everybody else, and to use them and try to include them. So what I'm saying, and Dr. Long can go into this, that people suffer from post-traumatic slave syndrome, post-traumatic slave disorder, which injured. You cannot include a sheepdog with the regular wolves and think that he's going to look out for the wolves. The sheepdog has been mentally injured. He's going to look out for the sheep because he thinks he's a sheep. So what Michael Tynes has said, that we have to work with those of like mind. And trying to make house Negroes in the field Negroes, that has never worked and got us in the situation that we have here. So what the brother has been doing is he's been working with those of like mind, and that's how you get the unity. We cannot try to bring the house Negro out to the field. We've lost. Every slave revolt that ever happened was because the house Negro sold out the field Negro. And what has happened is the house Negro dropped a bomb on the MOVE project in Philadelphia. It's the house Negroes who sold out Malcolm X, who sold out Martin Luther King, who sold out Fred Hampton. So those mentally injured individuals in the black family, they have to be excluded because they have been mentally injured and corrupt, and we have to do those who are with the same mind and same goal. Now, do you think I'm – is that correct, my brother? I'm talking to
I think –
No, I'm talking to the guest. I'm talking to the guest.
Go ahead, my brother guest.
Oh, yeah.
Go ahead, my guest.
Yes, I
want to
finish
asking the guest.
I'm sorry, go ahead.
Okay, go ahead, Marshon. Go ahead, Marshon. Thank you.
Oh, yes. It is something that is that you know, when you looked at the communities and you see what they've been through and our people have been through, in a sense, it's not as if there's a problem. You know, there's a problem when you wake up in the morning and you can't really just be you because you are everybody. And I don't think people understand what it's like to be black. And so, you know, the solutions we have are already prepared because, you know, like you said, we have 7 billion people in the world, right? And let's say you have 2 or 3 billion kids, right? All those youths and all the teenagers and all around the world, they all want to do what one day? They all want to come to America. That's probably the dream of probably everybody in the world, right? you know, just come to America if they're not in America. It's like, I wish I could get to America and have that freedom. So that's where we at right now, right? So we're looking at 2 billion people, hopefully some by some time, wishing that they could find a way to get to America. That's just a fact. On top of that,
that's
we
American
have
dream.
Our white and black American kids, you know what I'm saying, who want to be able to live and have the American dream ourselves. How is that going to work for us when you have this fluctuation of everybody coming here and we're talking about building? It's how we do this. So this is why we have went and opened up our relationships with the diaspora so that we create. Because, see, the first thing we want to do is we want to go and offer an opportunity for Japan, Mexico, China, Korea to open up 5,000 black businesses for us. Now, we're getting this reparation money as this starts to come and set in place. And so we're saying, look, when we get this thing, we would love to see you support us. Listen, we're only 7% of California's population. Represent 40% of the homelessness. How does that happen? That happens because nobody wants to hire or rent to us. That's how that happens. 40%, only 7% of the population, and they represent 40% of the homelessness. So when you see these laws that affect homelessness, they're affecting us in a country that we died and was hung on, and we have all these other people that – I'm sorry?
And throwing in great solutions. And you coming out of Compton, you coming out of L.A., you know, one of the solutions, we gotta use what we got to get what we want. Jesse Jackson said, is, you know, we like to quote folk, you know, what Jesse said, can't nobody help us but us. And at that point, mm-hmm. that means we got to start paying attention. Dr. King said, mm-hmm. our struggle is going to be that opportunities are going to start opening up to us. And we understand that we got to step up and be ready for that opportunity, even though we have the history and the depression that we have. We cannot use that as an excuse not to step up to the line and be ready. And so, case in point, if we got over 120 historical black colleges and they are not filled with our students, if we are not gathering our young people as they come out of these high schools, and if we're not encouraging them first to get their undergrad in one of these historical black colleges, then if we let them give us excuses, they don't want to go to college. College ain't for them just because they barely made it out of. That's the time they. And Dr. Tynes, you know, the struggle took a man for you to get to the level that you've got. How many of your partners have you been able to say, follow me in this directive, in this direction, and get your undergrad, and they followed us? So I think if we say to our people first, put your guns down, let's put our money together, let's start doing whatever we have to do. We know all the problems, and we hash them out. And I've written books on them. I say, let's write some more books so we can put the story out there, so when they want to hear what our story is, they got to buy the book. But right now, I think the conversation and dialogue is important, and we need to have it more, because to some of our young men, we need some more of them coming out of school magnum cum laude, and ain't nobody stopping them but them. They may have to go across country, but they have all the tools that they need to become millionaires if they want. If a young man say, I want to be a millionaire, a billionaire, or I want to be the mayor of the city, he's going to have a struggle either way, but he can get there, and we believe that. But a lot of our young men not believe in that. They're getting talked out of the game before they even come up to bat. They're losing by forfeit. So I think our energy should be, some people say, cut off the finger to save the hand. We might have to reach back to those 13 and 18, or that might be too late. Because some of young men are not teachable. They can be taught, but they're not teachable. Now, if you're dealing with a group of young people that can be taught, but they're not teachable, we got to figure out how do we teach them. We cannot give up on them. We got to go back and then come back.
Right.
Absolutely.
Thank you. I want to get back to our guest. You know, you were making some very important points. Yes. You were working. You were.
The key element is when we talk about the historical black college, we talk about kids going to college and setting that up, we're not ready for that yet. And the reason why we're not ready for that yet, because like I said, we got a black woman, goes to Yale, she graduates on the dean's list. Corporation is she going to get hired to. That's ready to take a black engineer right now, can hire her and pay her $150,000 a year or $250,000 a year. So we got to set our corporations up. We can send our kids to school in these 4 years, but we got to have our corporations ready for to hire them as soon as they graduate. So as soon as they get out of college, we can't take our great minds and send them over there to Google and everybody. And see, that's what's happening right now. So if we keep sending our kids to college, that's perfect. They'll graduate with their degrees, but they're not working for no African-American-owned name for corporations that can afford to pay them that kind of money. So we need to build that in perspective. So what we're doing now is the first thing we're doing is obligation, and it's cold for us to do it because once we start doing it, it's like everybody else starts doing it, and it just hinders us because it kills our market, and we can't do it in our own country. But I'm just going to say it anyway. So one of the things we're doing is we're training our black kids to break down electric cars and fix them up, break them down, fix them up, break them down and fix them up, take them apart, fix them up. So once they get and master this, now you're going to open up your stores, your auto shops, because right now all the mom and pop stores are only what, gas cars. So if we train our black kids to start doing this in our country, then we'll have our black kids being the first ones with these electric cars. But of course, once our black kids start training so we can prepare a future for them, everybody else gonna say, well, why don't our kids train on and do that too? You know what I'm saying? And start opening those businesses up. So now the competitive factor in the country that we got hung in, we gotta fight and compete with everybody. It's a difference if we just
but
have to
do
okay right doing it. But we got to deal with everybody doing it. We got to deal with everybody doing it. And nobody else has to deal
though
with that
this
in their country's instance. I understand that, and I give that opportunity, but in the same, but as
this
a...
is America. This is America, and
okay,
that means... ready,
let's,
set, go.
Guess,
ready, set, go. If we know we have a meeting tomorrow.
I guess we're working on projects that are absolutely working across the country.
No,
right,
I'm not knocking. I'm hearing it. I'm loving it.
Yeah. He's definitely got their plans that's working, that they have been monetized and they're getting more and more funds in even as we speak. That is working in our black
Amen.
Community. And so go ahead, miss, go ahead.
That's what we want to hear about.
Yeah, we're on satellites. We're on not Roku, being Roku. So we're changing the elements of what we're trying to do to get our kids to become engineering. So we train our kids. Yes, of course, all the fast food companies are going to go into kiosks. So we're training our kids on how to break and start and develop software and doing these kiosks. Now, if we can't have the American United States, that's fine, because we are black out here and we have what's called the diaspora. And the diaspora... 1.5 billion citizens. So if we compromise on that and start to focus our small businesses and our energy into that area, we cannot, because we built America. We can build another country. We don't have to flee. Start building our own here. We need sort of our historical black townships, in a sense, where we can work together, build, and walk outside, because in the country, it's hard to go find some eggs or milk from a black-owned business. I want to taste the African fruit. A fruit from Africa. I want to know what a fig from Africa tastes like. So I want a store like that that we can have here that we can buy and set that up. So we need distribution. We need those parts. So these are the things that we're in the process of working or securing, because the major thing is securing the infrastructure. We need distribution, manufacturing, and storefronts. Now, you say, for instance, if they gave black people $100 million for reparations right now, so here's our reparations, what does that mean? Everybody's going to raise their prices on everything. Black people are this. Chicken going to go up. Everything's going to go up. They're going to raise the prices on us. They're not going to treat us fair. They're not going to come. If you open up a store, they don't come support. We're only 7% of the population. So even if you had every black man in California had a business, that's only 7% of businesses in California. The patriots of California still will not ever support those black businesses. That's why black businesses only market to black people, buy black. We the only ones that got to put a sign up and say black owned. Only ones, because nobody comes in there, because generally once they come in and see what we selling, they go add it to their store. When Black China started opening up her eyelash company, I remember all these shops were just doing nails. Once she opened up her eyelash company, every nail shop in the hood started doing eyelashes. I'm like, wow, Wow. Maybelline came out with eyelash. I'm like, wow. Every time a black woman find a little thing that she can kind of center on and make a little bit of money with, everybody else see it and say, oh, nope, I got to jump on that market. So we have to find another market to create in, because the people, even though it's America, they won't give black people an opportunity to economically grow like you can grow in their country. You see, people got to understand, they have banks here in the United States of America. Asian, there's Latino banks. So when black people walk into a bank, they know it's not really that black, not many black banks. So Bank of America will treat you because they know you don't have options. But when someone else walk in there, they know they have bank options. So they're going to treat them differently. APR things going to be different with them. So we got to set up that standard. We don't need help to do it because everybody kind of tell us how to build economically. I'm sorry?
No, go ahead.
Well,
I was just,
everybody
you know,
is
I, I'm happy that
yeah, everybody is, yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah, you know, everybody is telling us how to build economically. Do you not understand that we was in this government and we fought? We are, there's nobody who can tell us how to deal with the white man. Yet they come and tell us how to deal economically as if the white man never bombed our stuff. And we're working on that. As with racism, blacks and white people can get through this. The problem is we got to cut the chain of racism off outside of the Indian, the Native Americans, and blacks. Only thing anybody else has experienced here is discrimination and prejudice. So we can't allow everybody to keep using our words. And this, again, will allow us now to start to get our culture back. What we need is our culture back. What we need is people to stop saying the word nigga and go back to their culture word for their friend or homeboy. What we need is people to stop listening to stop wanting to be a radio DJ, but just listen to the music. You turn on the Power 106, you're hearing Latin music on a hip-hop radio station, but you would never turn on a Latino station and hear black people as a DJ in there, and there's nothing wrong with it. But I'm just saying, we give everybody their space. We the only ones who can't have space. And then when we vote space, we're called racist. But that space is for our kids, because we are tired of allowing you to feed your kid off our culture before we feed ours. When are we going to wake up and say, look, bro, I have no problem with you, but I want my kid to eat in his culture before your kid. And I expect that your kid to eat in his culture before my kid. With all due respect. They come in there and they making you change and apologize for using words that urban black people create. Spaz is all word. We know what it is. It means to raise out on somebody, slap somebody up. But no, we got to go and apologize. Who is this urban person that speaks, that's talking about what spaz means? You can't tell a black person nothing about our language in Ebonics, because anything we say can be interpreted anyway. It has been like that for ages. So why are we allowing people to now take our urban Ebonics and tell us what Ebonics is? How do we allow that to happen? And so when that small light thing happens, and we allow that thing, when we allow that to happen, yeah, I'm sorry, go ahead.
I want to ask a question. Coming out of Compton and using that very thing that you said as an example, and using looking back, where our young people created a hip-hop industry and they made millions and billions, and some of the producers, Jimmy Iovine, them came out of the rock world, saw what was going on, came up with a plan, and they smoothly took it over, and some got rich and some didn't. My question to you, coming out of Compton, understanding that, using that as an example, how could we have kept that industry clean and kept that to ourselves?
Okay. Well, see,
okay.
It's hard.
Thank
because to hold the industry, you have to control the aspects of radio stations. Because you can, the key element, see, the thing is, we had the industry locked in because we had what was called DJ, the fourth element of hip-hop. And everywhere in our community, if you go to New York, you tell them about the hip-hop culture, they would have shows and events where people would do mixing. They would mix. It was turntable mixing. Turntable. Very, not easy to do. Very skilled sport. You have to be very skilled. It is not easy to mix. It's not easy to mix. It's very hard to do. So they would have these music, and they would play, and they would have these shows, and this is how everybody would get their music off, and they sing that. And they said, man, we need to take that and put it on the radio. But before we can establish our own radio station, what we should have been doing at the time and holding on to them, we use their radio station. And we'll pay you to put your music on. Okay, fine. You'll give me some money to play my stuff? Yeah, fine. So we jumped at the opportunity. You're going to give me some music to play your stuff to reach the people? Oh, it's great. We didn't understand what it was going to change into, that now once those radio stations become popular, you control and dominate what's being heard. And so without us controlling the aspects, see, we can open up all the business we want. But if we can't own a TV station to market to our people, if we don't have a commercial, make a commercial. But you still got to call them to get your commercial out. And we've been here 400 years. Why is that so? Why is that so? You can turn to everybody else, and they have their own network. We all know BET is not a black network. We know that. We know that. So why is it everybody has to touch ours? So it has to be a respect that has to be given out. It's pretty much a respect for everybody to sit back and say, you know what? We know that y'all been hung on trees. We know what y'all been through. And everybody's always eating. We can watch y'all get money. And that's the problem. They can't even watch this. They can't even watch us get reparations money. They can't even watch us get money for black loans or black things or black community or black women get businesses. As soon as black women get business, everybody getting upset. I can't wait for them to do it with us. Why? Why nobody can watch us get anything? After everything we've done in this country, never mess with anybody. Never our gang violence stayed in our community. So what we're doing is, like I tell the gang, in the gangs, I was out there about last month dropping things off because I got to do everything very incognito. But like I said, we're going to take our we want to change the flags, because the flags that we use are the bandanas. Our bandanas, what is this image on here? So we're going to create our own image, create 5 foot size bandanas, and we're going to create NFTs, and then we're going to go into our museum. Because, see, there's a mafia museum. The mafia wasn't nice people. They were very cruel people. We talk about the mafia. They did some heinous things. But if you go to Vegas, there's a mafia museum. They recognize that there were some heinous things that happened, but they've changed. Things have changed. We're now great citizens. And so the same thing with us. Why we can't celebrate the same way they do it? We always make it seem like for us it's different. And we let all these other races tell us that. Well, no more. No more. It's a new black man coming to the forefront. Right. It's too late to prepare for him. He already here. It's too late to prepare. No more. The thing is, we thank you, but we don't want no help right now. We can build it ourselves. And the problem is that what they do is because they couldn't do turntables. Yeah. They couldn't do turntables, so what they do, they made electric turntables where you just push a button. So now it's easier to be a DJ, and they cleared our market out. Because now, when it was only, if you do a turntable, maybe only 1-2 million people can probably do turntables. That would have shut it down different, you know, ain't that many people. But once you start pushing buttons, that allows anybody to do it, and it kills our market. You can never go into see black people as mariachi. It'll never happen. They would never let us come into that culture. They would never let us do that. We never would do anything like that. But they will come into ours and dominate, say they're the kings. And they will come into our culture and say they won't even do business with us. They will come into rap and say, I don't even do business with niggas. In our culture. Now, you imagine a black person saying, and if I was a mariachi performer, I would never sign to a Latino as a mariachi performer. I couldn't say that. The disrespect from our culture and their culture is just absurd. It's absurd. And we allow it to happen at the highest of levels.
You know,
and the only
so
people out here punishing right now in this country is black and white people.
Yeah, I'm so grateful for you, Marshon, what you're doing, what we're doing together, and you're so absolutely right. You know, we really, honestly, all y'all out there, we really can do this, and we are doing it, what Mr. Marshon is doing, and we haven't even touched upon not even a tenth of what is happening to, you know, the, Clutch the World organization. So we want to turn now. We've got other panel guests that we need to get to, as well as we've got guests with their hands up. Dr. Moncrease, and then Dr. Long, we want to give you opportunity. And then we're going to our guests. We're going to our audience with their hands up. And around to Jared, know that he has some things to say too, or ask. So, Dr. Moncrease.
Yes, thank you. I just want to start off by saying, wow. Wow, there's just so much information, and, you know, sometimes it can be too much. I was trying to pick out information to ask questions on, but then the topic would run off to something else, and all of it's important. So I'll just make a couple of comments, and then maybe Marshon can talk about that. We started talking off with the criminal justice system, and we never did get back around to it. But incarceration and recidivism is something that we're going to have to address, if not tonight, another time. He mentioned, you know, going and being homeless and going into a shelter and learning about things such as Section 8. Back here in Michigan, laws were passed. People on Section 8 generally lived in our large urban centers like the city of Detroit. But when laws were passed, when the housing market started not doing so well pre-COVID, that made it so if you had an abandoned home on your street, you could not have a Section 8 home on that street. That moved a lot of the Section 8 business out into the suburbs. White people got a plan, you know, they do. And that was a way that they could keep their neighborhood getting guaranteed income. We jumped around to the descendants of enslaved Africans versus other descendants of Africans. And, you know, I think we need to look out for ourselves as descendants of enslaved Africans. I think we need to make that a priority. But I also don't want to fall into the trap, and I hear our conversations falling into the trap of us being against people who are not descendants of enslaved Africans. And I don't care how you clean it up and say that's not what I meant. That's what people are hearing. At least that's what I'm hearing. I think we should just focus on what we can do for us as descendants of enslaved Africans. And if other people of African descent come here and they want to do things, I'd say, you know, all power to them. You know, I don't want to be the divisive against people who look like me. I just think that's the ultimate plan that white people have. Not all white people, but the ones who want to keep us down, that their plan is to keep us fighting among ourselves about things that we don't need to. We know we need to give priority to ourselves, and we know we need to be working for ourselves. We know we need to have our own businesses. And the other thing we jumped to was reparations. You know, and we have reparation think tanks, and I think that's very, very important. I mentioned a few weeks ago about we needing our own black medical schools, and our own black medical schools need to be paid for out of reparation money. And the money needs not to be coming just over 5, 10, 20 years. The money needs to come over 200 years. So anytime somebody tells me that they're going to give you $8 million or $800 million in reparations, it's not enough. It's not enough. It's not enough money, and it has to be given in, at least, like I said, for over 200 years. Those people who suffered, the Jewish people who suffered at the hands of the Germans and after the World War II, they still get reparations now. We get nothing, and they're still getting reparations now. So, you know, we just jumped to so many different topics that, you know, it just made it hard for me to just sit back and absorb it all. You know, I'm gonna cut it off. But when Dr. Cannon asked the question, you know, what do we do for people 13 to 18 years old? My ears perked up. We had a ton of conversations, but I didn't hear the plan. And so tonight was just wild. There's just so much information out there. Marshon, if I had a hat on, it would be off to you. I just wish we could, you know, focus and get things done. I just wish we could focus. Thank you.
Thank you, Marshon. If you could respond, but I would like for you to address what's going on for 13 to 18 years old in your project.
Well, what we're doing is focusing on is we are focusing on, like I said, the electric program starting from 13, you know, to 18 years old. We are starting catering classes. So we're looking at African cuisine, African foods. We're going to be teaching our young women how to make this cuisine, and then we're going to give them their own food trucks. So they have their food trucks that they can take, so they start off at 18 with their own business already off top. You know, we are wanting to develop a nice special program, like when a young woman turns 16 years old in the black community, she has to make dinner for the whole family. And then the whole family comes and just put money in this big old pot for her. But we want to make sure that we have a lot of these communal things that happen in our community. And so we've partnered with a lot of different organizations that are making, we have one company that's making, they make perfumes. And so with these perfumes, we're going to go into our inner cities, and we'll see. One of the things we're doing is we have them gangs. There's a lot of gang injunctions. So what we're doing in the company is I'm calling them community units. We're not going to call them gangs. We're calling them community units because, you know, when there's a federal indictment of gangs, I don't want to be like, oh, you know, it's just gangs out there because that's going to be in the fair. So we say community units. So the community units out there in Compton, you know what I'm saying, because there ain't no gangs out there because then that's like snitching. You know, the community units out there, what we're looking at is being able to utilize them and partner them, and we want to get back to our basics. So we want to do backflipping contests. You know what I'm saying? We want to go back to double dutch contests where now these different community units can start having their own nonprofit organizations, and they can start putting on their own showcases where it's now this community unit versus this community unit and backflipping and basketball and video games and different sports, and now they're raising money because now it's this community unit versus this community unit, and it's different tournaments that's set in place. So utilizing opportunities that we have within our culture is what we're trying to do to bring that in there, stuff that we can control that it'd be hard for other people to do. So I need to be able to, you know, have my people, the youth, be able to create their own custom things. So we're going into things like oceanography because oceanographers make $80,000 a year or more. So we want to teach our teens about filming wildlife and wildlife, you know. And so when you look at these things, these are jobs that they can go overseas when you learn oceanography. You know, a lot of these companies, when they send you over the world to film these things, they send you over for 2 or 3 years, and you get paid a lot of money going and traveling. So there's a lot of job opportunities in oceanography and videography or wildlife videography, you know what I'm saying, things of that nature that we're targeting teens on to do, that we know there's jobs within America as well as the diaspora for. So main program right now is to train our youth and set them up to prepare for creating business within the diaspora, you know, and the diaspora to us is like working with Haiti. So when you talk about the programs, you talk about the people in Haiti, my objective and my goal for Haiti is essentially, you know, we have these people and we train them in certain skills. They have a lot of earthquakes and they have a lot of floods there. So our goal, as you say, what there were, what, there were 10,000 Haitians that came across the border. So if we train 1,000 into our registered nurse, 1,000 into CNA, 1,000 into contractors, 1,000 into carpenters, 1,000 into plumbers, and then we kept going until we got to 10, and now we have them all trained in the last 6 months, in the last, you know, 2 years, we trained them with all these skills, and we all went back to Haiti with these skills, and they now started to do the forming. They now started to learn how to form and build vertical, because they got to build vertical because of the floods that happened there. So they need vertical forms there. So when we start to do these things set up in there, we can create these people, teach them that why they're here in our country, and then we can have them go back, because it's time for us as African Americans to start building all of our countries up. You know, and going in there and aspect up. We don't have to run to a country for help. We can go and start taking what we have, the objective, the businesses, the things that we create here, and we can take that to, you know, a homeless guy here knows how to fix a car. Some of the homeless people are homeless because they used to work on cars. So our homeless team here can work on cars in Africa, can work on cars in Haiti. There's places there where they need people that know how to work on cars, know how to do these things. So we find these skills and we start to fine tune it so we can utilize this in the diaspora. And then we train our youth to understand these things so that way they understand corporate, they understand business, but they got to learn it right now because I don't want to do the job thing for our youth right now. We need business. So as soon as they turn 18, here's your trailer, here's your truck. Go out there and get it in. Here, young man, here is your organization for your project, for your nonprofit to go ahead and stop this violence or stop whatever it is. We just want to make sure that they have strong objectives. And so that's what the goal is. Electric car companies, once they fix and learn electric cars, here is your shop. You're going to hire other kids working at the shop so now we can fix all electric cars, learn how to fix the electric car batteries. What about the charging stations for electric cars? If a charging station breaks down, who can fix it? Well, we're going to train our kids how to fix the electric car. So what happens? Oh, my charger broke for my electric car. No problem. We can fix that. Bam, our teams are going to fix it. So we know where the jobs are at. We're going to train our teams to get ahead of those jobs where it's at, out front.
Thank you.
I think that's brilliant, Doctor. I like that.
This addresses the 13 to 18 and even beyond. And we're not, it's a dream that is actually manifesting right now. And so, you know, I wanted you all to understand and to hear this, because this is what Dr. Lee is about. Neighborhood Commerce Institute is about. You know, it's about entrepreneurship. And so we talk week to week to week to week about the issues, about the problems, about the black and white problem. We know what that is. But we do, it's up to us as a people. It's up to us to make these changes and to create. Dr. Lee could care less if we're talking, if this is a Blood or Crip. No, they're community units, okay? They are community units. And so what we have access to, what we know how to do, and the visions and dreams that we do have, we bring all of our organizations, all of our skills, you know, all of our ideas together, and we start manifesting, you know. We are manifesting right now. Now, what's going on in Compton, it's not that's where it's at or starting or where monies have already manifested, okay? I mean, we're not talking about projects that, you know, what Marshon is talking about are being monetized right now. No, it's not going to be, but is right now. And so he is a prime example right here in Compton, you know, of what we can do as black people. You know, you take what we have. We take what we have and we use it. This young man is all over the country. He's throughout the diaspora right now while we're speaking. So, yo, we know what the 400 years have done to us. And we know about the post-traumatic stress syndrome that's going on with us. But we as a people, we have to come together and fix it, utilizing what we have and people who have the type of organizational skills that Marshon has, the ability to bring us together so many organizations. And then create more organizations, you know, with the young people, 13, 18 years old. You know, and then be able to tap into the system. And this is what we always talking about. I'm always talking about we have to use the system. We have to use them. There are no shortcuts around that. And it's about organizing, getting on board, not judging, taking people where they are right now, where they are right now, and then developing that skill, that thing that they want to do within these kids. I mean, they have desires. You know, yes, gang banging and all this is going on, but look what Killer Mike did. I don't know if anyone knows about it, but, you know, he took Crips and Blood, and they came together. He created a business, an industry, because they're already out there. Whatever they're doing, they're operating businesses. May not be legal businesses, but they're operating businesses. You take those same skills and apply it to their real dreams, to their real vision. So they came up with, you know, Killer Mike helped them to come up with a soda drink, you know, a cola, and the Crips got a cola out there, that and these are on the market. And, you know, they're coming together and they're bringing peace amongst themselves through entrepreneurship. The Bloods have a red drink out there. So what we're talking about is real folks. These are weird. The gang members are human beings. They're human beings. They were born just like us, with the same drive, same God, same different types of desires within them that they want to manifest. But they were introduced and listen, the game, I mean, we didn't create this. We didn't create this. So that's another history story, history lesson. We didn't create what's in our neighborhoods right now. But we can fix it, and we can turn it around. I want to go to Dr. Long, and you've been so silent, but we want to get around to everyone. This is a great, I love Touch the World, Marshon, and you know I do. We want just to, yeah, we are together going to clutch the world. And I thank God for you. I really, really do. And I consider it divine that, you know, that we were, that we have met and that we are moving forward the way God has ordained for us to move forward. And so, Dr. Long.
Thank you, Dr. Mary Lee. I want to applaud Mr. Kincy on his efforts and his mission, wishing him much success. As I was listening to the conversation, similar to Dr. Moncrease, I was going one direction and I kind of turned another direction. So I did have some questions for Mr. Kincy as this regarding his interactions with establishing his relationship with his daughter in the midst of the abandonment from her mother. And so I had some questions regarding whether or not he had to experience any of the challenges dealing with DHHS, CPS. Was there any process of reunification? And the reason I'm asking that is that I hardly ever talk about another part of my job that probably the part that I dislike the most is when making a decision on what parent, if any parent, is going to maintain their rights to that child. So that was one question. But as he was going on in terms of entrepreneurship, I had a lot of notes, actually. And so I guess my question to him, my overall question, would be, how does he understand and how does he deal with what I believe, and some, you know, we've all said this over the years, how do you deal with our war on our own denial? And what I kind of conceptualize as our domino effect of distrust. So, you know, as you guys were talking, I was writing down different historical businesses created by black folks, particularly in Detroit, and those who are on the call may remember the Bell Broadcasting Company. I think it was the second oldest black-owned radio station in the country. Started by two dentists, Dr. Bell and Dr. Wendell Cox. You know, that doesn't exist anymore. It's not in our ownership. Second big, what used to be an icon, and I'm looking at the news most recently as we celebrate the expansion of the Motown Museum, and where you have a billionaire, Dan Gilbert, donating $43 million to that expansion and renaming it the Rocket Plaza. So my question is, how do we how does Mr. Kincy combat our own denial when it comes to our level of autonomy, of ownership, freedom, et cetera, while also maintaining his mission? Dr. Tynes has put it in different phases in terms of, you know, the syndromes and things like that. And particularly, how do you deal with it when you're dealing with very young people? I would just say, as a psychiatrist, you know, I don't hold any punches with the kids that I see. We don't have time to sugarcoat things. I just try to present it just as it is. But like I've mentioned before, you know, the first thing I have to do is sit and listen. So, again, great conversation tonight, but it did stimulate a lot of thoughts, and even writing down particular iconic businesses that were once owned in Detroit, but not owned by Detroit. And I would just say this as sort of a sarcasm. They had Otis Williams and Smokey Robinson here for the new grand opening of the Motown Museum, i.e. Rockets Plaza. And I kind of thought it was kind of ironic that the song that they wanted the Temptations to sing was Ain't Too Proud to Beg. So, you know, that subliminal meaning is, I don't think it was subliminal, really. But it's just, so those are my questions. But again, I want to congratulate Mr. Kincy on his efforts, and I'll sit back and listen.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Vaughn.
When you look at the aspects of it, let's go back to the shoe lasting and the cotton gin. You see, when you talk about the shoe lasting, what, 90% of shoes in that time and era, was the shoe lasting was invented by a black man. 90% of the shoes that was made at the time, they took that, snatched that, and pretty much made, they controlled and dominated and took all that money. It was a $1 trillion industry. You know, it's the same thing with the cotton gin. Think what, 90%, 95% of all cotton was made once the cotton gin came. In fact, when Eli Whitney invented the cotton gin, it took slaves back into slavery. We actually was kind of free from the war, and because he invented the cotton gin, they was back in slavery. You know what I'm saying? So from that part, you got to look at the things we done. Now, now even going further, let's just talk about the Moulin Rouge in Las Vegas. You see what I'm saying? When we had our own black casino, what happened? They had to bomb it. Stop making fool gold there, and they destroyed it. And they said, you'll never, Negroes will never, ever have another Las Vegas casino. So it's not as if I have to tell my people, like, we are failures. I can't say that. It's because they have cheated us. We get tripped. So it's hard for me to be like, oh, well, you need to fix this and fix this. How do I fix something when these people keep putting their foot out tripping us? So I can't really be realistic to my people and say, well, you need to do this for your business, because every time we do, there is some kind of systematic change that happens that allows them to be able to win from it, because they won't allow us to make that profit from ourselves. So it's not no black-owned car companies. So when you talk about black-owned businesses and what we need to do is something that is hard for us to have, because if you look at the commercials, I just seen a commercial with the KFC. I got a big old bowl for $5. I got a big old bowl for $5. I got a big old bowl. Are you serious? This is our culture. And so when everybody can take that and that energy that we present and use that for their own, how can you expect them to give that back to you? Listen to the commercials. You know, go ahead. We used to have the noise. You know, ain't like Folgers in your cups. Now it's just hip hoppity bomb bomb, get it done, shake it, shake it, shake it, get it there, shake your new car with the new Visa shake car. I mean, everything is just black. Everything is urban. So when it's all that, how do I make a commercial that I can represent my people that looks like people will know, well, this is a black thing? We can't, because everybody looks like a black thing, like it's a black CEO. And that's what they'll do. We'll get a black CEO, and now we can just have all our stuff wrapped. We can't even say drip. You say the word drip, drip will be in every clothing line, every swap meet you go, you see drip shirt. Like, who is drip? Who made drip? As soon as black people bling, bling, you see bling, bling on every shirt, every jersey, every shirt come up, bling, bling, bling everywhere. There's not a word that we can say. I can create YOLO right now. YOLO, homie, can stop YOLO, YOLO. And by next week, YOLO will be somewhere on somebody's jersey. Somewhere it's being sold, somebody making money from, like, dang, he just said, and that man, he got it all over the thing. You see what I'm saying? So there is a type of energy that's hard to get my people to understand. Like, you know, it's not like it's nothing in your way. It's just kind of like, you know, man, people can't see you to get on. Like, you know, like, I don't know how to explain it. We have to address them. Like, you know what I'm saying? Like, the only way for us to move ahead is we literally have to address them. Like, can we open up this business and get time to open up a manufacturing plant and time to get distribution in the storefront? Because it might be taking about 6 months to get that in place. But we want to sell this new creative idea we got. Can we do that in our country without it getting implemented so we can start to begin a process of funding for us? Because what happens is once that founding base is set and we start making money, people are looking. You got to imagine if there was a village and there's 10 people in this village and the law is everybody got to hunt for his family. The one guy that's bringing food every single day, the other 9 are going to get envious. They're going to get jealous. See, black people have had it so hard in this country. We have learned how to eat when circumcision was a bit. When they wasn't hires, what do? We start selling bootleg DVDs. Now, see, when other people started selling, they were selling oranges on the freeways. You never seen black people start selling oranges on the freeway. That's y'all hustle. Y'all get y'all money. We not mad at nobody hustling getting their money. The problem was when they seen us selling bootleg DVDs, they start selling it too, and they start selling it for cheaper. So now the poorest black man who has absolutely nothing is sitting there out of jail trying to make some money selling bootleg DVDs. He got to compete with every immigrant now. And there's nothing wrong with it. This is the poorest of the poorest of the black men. So now he got to compete with all the other black dudes that's poor on their luck trying to sell DVDs, and now everybody else is selling bootleg DVDs. But we don't touch their industry. So the problem is saying, like, we can't even hustle from a small illegal area selling bootleg DVDs without getting Mars on. So how do I tell my youth that something's wrong when it's just like, man, we just can't keep in Bogart? That's why I'm saying it's so necessary for us to go into the diaspora, to train our youth, to train our kids in captain classes. That's why I'm out here in the town islands. A lot of white people who love us, man, love training the kids to become captains. Take them out there on the boat so that this way now you can take black people out on boats. You can take them out fishing. So we can use 100 boats right now easily. So when we train these black kids to become captains, now here's your boat. You got a boat that can hold 30 people. You can take these people fishing. You can take these people. They can go play gas. They can go play cars. You can take these people in the boats. Now y'all got jobs. You buy you a boat. Here's your captain license. And you set off and go to make some money. We got to put certain things for our kids to go because we can't put them into regular economic commerce because it gets too devoured. So that's why we have to clutch them. And so that's why the clutch the world is set in place to grab a hold and hold on to them, not from the short term, but all the way. Because if we not hold on to them, somebody going to come grab them. With all due respect, it's nothing personal, but I love my people more than I love your people. Nothing personal. And you should love your people more than mine. With all due respect, I know there's an equal, but when it comes to feeding my child, I should be able to feed my child with my product, and you should be able to feed your child with my product. And when she finished eating, I don't have a problem taking what she has and saying, here, you can have some of this. She didn't eat it all. But that's the problem. They come and they have to take away from our own kids to eat. And that's the problem. And we don't do it to anybody else. We can't go do it to anybody else. We're not going to go and, I mean, we're going to become, you know what I'm saying, mariachi stars and start going into other cultures or doing Asian stuff. We're not going to go into nobody else's culture. We don't do that. We had Eminem. They had Boohoo and the Blowfish. That was the trade right there. Who in the brokerage, even a good trade done. You don't have to do it anymore. It's over. Now let's move forward and make sure our culture has what we need to move forward. We need everything. We can't afford to share nothing right now. With all due respect, we can't afford to share nothing. The children of shadows are coming. There's no reason for us to be sitting there sharing with anybody.
Yeah, as you said earlier, they keep coming in anyway. For example, in California and well across the country, we all know that there have been breakfasts provided in schools, you know, for primarily in the low income, the black community. And so now in California, not only do the low income people get breakfast, but now regardless as to income level, all the schools are providing breakfast and lunch free, you know, throughout the state of California, whether it's charter school, private school, or whatever it is. Now, that's a prime example of what Mr. Kincy has been talking about all night long. And what for us, everybody ends up with it. And it's absolutely clear that's what goes on. And so it's extremely, it's direly important for us to build our own and to serve our own. And it's, and you know, it's about us. It's about us black people right now. It was, it has been all along, but we must, we cannot, they think about themselves. That's who they think about. But there's laws in place, there's funding in place that has happened that where the low income and the black communities were earmarked, but we don't get it all. We do not get anything that has been designated for us 100%. We don't. We don't. Just like this lunch program.
And when you look at it, it's because everybody want to be on our boards. If you go look at when it comes to the black community, everybody wants to help and say, oh, I'll be on the board. I'll help you guys. And it's all these other races want to be on the board. Like, it's no way possible that you want to be on our boards. Like, you love my people more than your own people. Go on your own boards. Why are you, why are all these other races on our African-American reparations boards? Why? Why? You will never see on any of the black people are not interested in being on any Latin, Asian, European. We're not interested in being on anybody's board unless it pertains to us. Why is it so that everybody wants to be on our board member when it comes to this person's money? So they can learn what they're doing. They can see what they is. You can't love me more than your people. So when people sit back and say, oh, I'm fighting for love and I'm fighting, you're not going to fight for me more than you fight for your own people. You're not made like that. You're not made like that.
Right.
With all due respect, your people are not made like that. So you're not going to sit there and make me believe that you're going to fight for me. We're all 100% over your people because you have not shown that in your effort. And I'm jealous about that. I want my people to have that same appeal. The same way with you, you see how Tijuana, Ensenada, what's your name, all have riots over the weekend? Nobody got killed, but they just start burning stuff up just to let you know y'all are here too long. The prices started going up. Then when the white people in that country, the prices started going up. Things started to go value. So they had a whole riot. Go back to y'all country. We can't go here. Y'all can't come. So they said, no more going back to America now. Y'all can't go back to Tijuana right now. That's done. So all the white people have to come back. But it's different when it comes this way. We can't go here. We can't go nowhere but free our families and get peace. Where can we go? We fought for peace here, and we can't enjoy it because everybody's seen the peace that we got and said, damn, I want that. And instead of them turning around saying, you know what, I'm going to do what black people did. I'm going to have many bloody summers. I'm going to have as many bloody summers as I can. I'm going to do as much rioting and picketing until my government breaks, until he gives us freedom. No, we're just going to go where the African-Americans fought for it at, come near, and then we're going to make sure that they can't even eat in their own country that they built. America is the most beautiful woman on the planet. If you put every country up and you make them all women, America is that. She is the bomb. And who dressed her? Who gave her those legs and those thighs and those arms and that hair and those beautiful eyes? Everybody want to come. Nobody want to make her. Everybody want to come hit it. But nobody want to make her. And we did that. So we got to go and take and make another one. With all due respect, we can make another one. All we got to do is just, get everybody else out the way. It ain't about unity. We know what to do. If we just, they're not going to buy from us. So we don't have to worry about, they're not going to buy from us unless they own it. If they own it, they're going to buy it. But when it's 100% black owned, it's not getting supported. It's not getting supported.
Okay.
Every time we get something, they always buy it out.
All right.
So that was,
we're wrapping it up now. We're wrapping it up.
Okay, I'm sorry.
No, you're good. You're good. We're gonna go to Jared. Jared, I think might have a couple questions. We're gonna address those. Then we're gonna go all the way back around where everybody gets to speak again, and Mr. Kincy, you'll respond, and you'll be the last voice to sum up everything tonight. And also, we definitely want to ask you to come back. And we will be bringing on some of the organizations and some of the leaders who are working with, with Clutch the World, who are also phenomenal. We're probably going to ride this track for a minute. So that you can get to know, the project, the extent of it. And this is a multi-million dollar a project that is happening right now. And, you know, God has been, doors have been opened, you know, for some phenomenal financial for funding in so many, in various different ways, but it definitely did not come easy, and it has been fought for, and I appreciate you, Marshon, for standing ground all the way, and fighting. And so there's a lot that all of us, all of us entrepreneurs and project planners can glean. This is just a introduction tonight, really, what is happening, you know, right out of Compton. And so, Jared, and so we're gonna wrap it up, but we're gonna continue. We're wrapping it up for tonight, but we're gonna continue this conversation, Jared.
Brother, thank you so much, Dr. Lee. Always, the show is a blessing. It truly, truly is, brother Kincy. Oh my God, Lord. Yeah. Okay. So the Lord woke you up one morning with a finger in your soul, and He ain't took it out yet. That live wire has got you on and popping, brother. Amen. Amen to you and everything you've been doing. So the question that I had, and this is something it ties into something that Dr. Cannon brought up, and Dr. Tynes touched on the family aspect, and there's another mastery that kind of got glossed over a bit that you have that I want to get your perspective on, and that's, you know, troubled fatherhood. You know, like you said, there are no programs and things out there for single fathers. Damn sure not any for single black fathers, right? We've lived through more than 40 years of attacks and you know, detriment about black fatherhood, right? You know, like deadbeat dads and all this and that. Hell, Oprah made a mint off of that. You know, but there's never been any of that repair. And Dr. Tynes brought up something that was important, which is that there's this new pernition that's happening with that, co-opting black women over to this feminist movement, which is not for them, but it's causing them to become adversarial towards us. As a man who's lived through that and a brother with your perspective and everything else, how do you see that, and how do you see us being able to integrate that back in to solve and heal a lot of those wounds that have been created by that?
Thank you. Like I said, my daughter, her mom never really came back to her life. They kind of got back when they were 15. So I kind of was able to file for full custody of my daughter, and I just raised her. They had their little things and stuff, but she kind of came back once she came 15. But of course, my daughter kind of knew. And the situation was there, so, you know, that's how that kind of played out. She kind of never really came back. And for me, it's like, you know, for us, when we talk about our women, you know, it's the thing is that we as black people, we don't have the businesses to hire our women to give them the necessary needs outside of owning strip clubs, outside of bringing them to twerk for the clubs and everything. With all due respect, you know what I'm saying? It's nothing personal, but the thing is, we have an element that we take our women to. We say I'm in love with a stripper. This was our culture. I'm in love with a stripper. And then when our women who admire her, black men, said, you're in love with a stripper, that's what you want, then I'll become that stripper. We got mad. Say, you're a hoe. You're a whore now. But you said you're in love with a stripper. Now, if black people were saying, black men was running around, I'm in love with registered nurses, I'm in love with CNAs, then guess what? We'll probably have a majority of women say, oh, that's what the stars and that's what they want. They all want nurses. I'm going to go get a nurse. And so a lot of times we look at women and it's like, you know, I have cousins that I game up. So when you talk about, well, you know, I'm going to tell my cousin, my female cousin, get them. Go take them, go to them, and give them. That's what we train on the real. You know, as a father, I'm going to be like, go to dinner with him. But, of course, we as men, like, oh, she's going to dinner, he's got to pay. But we train this into our women. Now, so, I mean, you know, so we got to look at, it's the same aspect that everybody else has. The thing is that we don't control the aspects of the livelihood for our women. And so as black men, we need more corporations. We can hire our women to be our CEOs, be our management companies, you know, and run these strong elements. The black woman took the black man, the white man, to the moon. She can take us to the diaspora. She can take us to the sun. She already did that. But we just got to put ourselves in position, because the first thing they say is women can't lead. Women can't lead. Then who's supposed to be leading? Because if she's off and she is sideways, whose fault is it? It is not the leader's fault? Oh, no, man, we got too much going on right now. We got this. What do you mean? No. He had her hand on her, and I understand that. But you slap his hand off, and we get it right the right way. But we got to make sure we can hold on to him. We can't just bring him into the music industry and then smash him out and then want them to hold on to some substance. So when we don't have the substance, black, I work with a lot of women. I'm smashing nothing. I've been asking them for 6 years. I'm going to get the job done because I wanted wisdom like Solomon. I know his main flaw was what was women. So if I want to be out here and move the way I want to move, I don't want nothing in my way. I don't want no distractions. I don't want God to be angry with me because lust. So I have to admit, get rid of those things to press myself forward. See, I'm in Latin. I study from the Emerald Tablets. So I understand from her recent thoughts, and I listen to it so I can gain a different type of wisdom. And so when I see this, it's kind of like our women have to be able to be able to have something where we can code without them being broken, without having to do nothing strange, to be able to get ahead. So our women should own their own strip clubs if they're going to be strip clubs. The men should own it so that way they won't be seduced and they can hold on to their power and they get their money because it's only women that are known to strip to get through college. Well, what do men do to get through college? Why can't women do what men do to get to college? Why is it normal in our America for women to strip through college? Why is it normal? So if we don't create elements, our kids are going to college. All the family members need to make sure we got $100 set every month to make sure our kids going to college. So we're going to make sure community units, every community unit, if you got somebody going to college, that community unit, we responsible to making sure they person got $100. Everybody put $25 in the community unit into their pocket, man, they in college. They going to be the lawyer for the hood. That's going to be our lawyer when she finished. So everybody put the money right there. We start taking our women and say, that woman's for our community unit. So nobody smashed her out. It's supposed to be when you come from our community unit, and for 30 years, man, no man betting, I never touch you. Man, you from the block, but no man ever put their hands on you. As soon as a man touch our woman, she should be able to go to the block in the community unit, come out like, what happened, bro? That's what we need to do. And if we focus our energy on that and secure that part, then we good to go. But it takes the leaders to take the place in there. We can't keep saying the women been pulling. God says the women, they ain't leading, they just pulling. They've been pulling. They're the highest in the education on the planet. There ain't no more person, more educated with degrees than our women. But we can't say they lead because it's out of order. Well, then we got to step up because they pulling like a mug right now. And they don't have nothing to pull it to. They just pulling around. Where is our black corporations with all those degrees? Here, come right here. I got the engineer company for you. I got the satellite company for you. I got the tech company for you. That's what we need to have with all these degrees. I got the lawyer company for you. We can't keep doing like the Dominguez firm. Dominguez firm, you look at that picture, it's all Latinos in the Dominguez firm. But you look at the Coffin firm, it's all mixed with everybody. We can't keep doing that. We need all our lawyers, all on board, all at the same time, moving them at the same pace, at the same time, like everybody else. There's nothing wrong with that. We can still love everybody. We just need to love ourselves, our facts, just love our children a little bit more. And if we could do that, we could.
Thank you so much.
Amen.
Yes, I'm so sorry. I couldn't get my phone off of mute. I think Marshon has said it all. I would have loved to talk a little bit more about how Monica where he found his way to when he was homeless. How that came into. You know, being homeless in Compton and finding a shelter there, that would have been interesting. But just so much. Just thank you. Thank you. Good night.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Go ahead.
Yeah, Santa Monica. I went to my mom knew some people at the shelter because I had my daughter, and it was like, you know, I was kind of sleeping in my car, and I'm just being arrogant because I don't want nobody to know I'm sleeping in my car because I honestly thought that if they see me sleeping in the car, my daughter, I didn't have a house, they would take her from me. So I was so afraid of them taking her that I kind of sheltered it. to an offense, I felt like I was on the run. I didn't know as a man that there were AFDC, that I could get help, that I could have got housing, I could have got a helmet, I could have got service. I didn't know about those things because as a guy, you know what I'm saying, you don't know these type of things. And I didn't learn that until after, you know, almost a year, until I got into the shelter, after a year of being homeless. So you have to remember, I was a year before I got into the shelter homeless. So, you know, it was downtown LA, and that time when, you know, you could stay in downtown LA and you could probably get like a good room for like $300 a month in downtown LA. You can have a good room for like $300 a month, you know? And so as you start to get that, it starts to get a little wild when you got a baby. And it's like, well, I can't have this baby down here now. I gotta go, you know what I'm saying? So once I was able to get the car, it was like I kept getting pulled over. You know, because I'm driving around with my daughter. So when the police pull me over, I got my daughter, my license suspended. So, you know what I'm saying? This is why I went to homeless court. And I'm like, you know, well, she won't fall asleep, man. So I just trying to drive around. I got a suspended license, but they always gave me a pass. They never took me in. Suspended license and everything, but I was like, I'm just trying to put my daughter to sleep, man. So that's how I pretty much got away the year of just going around. If I'm sleeping in, like, man, every time I start the car, she starts crying, so I'm just keeping the sleep. So if I got caught sleeping somewhere, the people are like, that's a strange car sleeping out in the front. They come, I just got my daughter sleeping right here because she won't sleep if I start the car. So I'm just letting her rest right now because she finally went to sleep, man. I'm afraid to start the car and she wake up. So I always had sort of a little pass, you know. And so, you know, those were just the things that once I got into the shelter, you know, and like I said, being only male in that shelter, you just heard the stories of all the abuse and everything that happened there. It just really kind of triggered that I understood change. And this came from every different ethnicity. It wasn't just like it was just black women. There was every woman. But I guess I kind of just centered, like, man, I can see where, you know what I'm saying? It just woke me up to a lot of different things. And from that point, I just started looking at life a whole lot different. So that was probably one of the biggest changes in my life is going through that.
Thank you, my brother. Thank you.
Thank you. Dr. Long.
Again, great show, Dr. Lee. And again, I want to applaud Marshon for all the work he's doing. One question or one thought I had at a recent family reunion, I actually met a young cousin of mine. Her name is Melissa Butler, and she's the founder of the Lip Bar. And I guess, you know, it's been on different Facebook and things like that. I think she even went on Shark Tank to get some funding. But, you know, as I think about it and with, you know, thoughts in terms of how we don't support our businesses, and, you know, I do think there's more of a psychodynamic sort of issue with us. But, you know, My question to Marshon would be, what advice would you give Melissa as it relates to her entrepreneurship, her business, in lieu of other iconic businesses such as Fashion Fair, and, you know, in terms of what led to the ultimate demise of that, that, you know, at one point had the presence in all the regions in Black America in terms of fashion, cosmetics, and things like that. So I guess I want to end my comment with a question to Marshon as it relates to that.
It's not that we don't support and we won't support a lot of their Black business. The thing is that we don't have the continuous advertisement and branding to shift at the level we need to shift to get people kind of addicted to what we have on the table. You know, when you look at what we can do it like what Beats Headphone does it. But once we get it there, it gets bought out. So we never get to see this stagnation. Like I tell people, as an economic developer and I'm a corporation, I say I want my business to be like, for instance, Magic Johnson Company. I want my company to be like Magic Johnson's company. But when I go to, I see that he owns the Dodgers, I say to myself, well, what's the name of his company? You see what I'm saying? And that's where we as entrepreneurs go at, because it's like, I want to be like Magic Johnson, but what's the name of his company? And I can't find the name of his company. So when you look at these Black successful companies, it's like they we don't have, when I say someone like Bill Gates, you already know. When I say Jeff Bezos, you already know. I say Elon Musk, I got to say their company name. So we need black names that when we can say this, there's a brand that comes to it. So, you know, so that way she has a place to say, okay, I want to be just like that company. You know, and so for us, it's generally, I don't know if she controls the manufacturing part of the process, you know, if that's in place, you know, getting a storefront, that's in place. But then when you start in a product like that, you want a storefront online or you want to get it in place, getting it franchised, how to set that part out is difficult in the sense that's something that, you know, for me, I would like to focus more with the youth. And getting the youth on that project to where that's part of the PE classes and part of that project works with the PE classes for our young women. So that way we guarantee sales of it, we guarantee the distribution of it, and we distribute directly just to our young women to train on, to practice on, and this is one of the tools that's used in our community. And so that way now it has a secondary hub, and we know that this is our culture. So that way, when like we were saying, when a young black man turns 11 years old, we want to give him, well, he needs to learn how to change brakes on a car. And once he learns how to change brakes on a car, he now gets his first watch. You see what I'm saying? Now you get a man watch, man, because you know how to do something like a man, and now you get this watch. And so this watch that we give him is our branded watch. It's a watch that's relative to our culture and our theme. So whoever manufactures that watch, every young man that's born is going to get that watch. So we need to culturize our products, make them part of our culture so that they're unique and that we can hold on to them so that that way we start to create the economic development we need within our culture without having to be supported by everybody.
Great, thank you.
Thank you so much. I appreciate you so much, Marshon. Dr. Cannon.
Outstanding show. I appreciate everybody tonight. You know, Brother Marshon, I think I may have listened to or followed you on one of your clubhouses. If that's accurate and so, could you speak just for a moment to our audience about the power of the new tools like Clubhouse and how and why we should be over there and dominating, and a little bit about your experience?
Well, to be honest with you, I think maybe you heard a clip that I did on someone. I have not been on social. I don't have a Facebook, Twitter. Like I said, this is my rookie year. So, like, you know what I'm saying? I've been on the boat for the last 2 years. You know what I'm saying? Just, you know what I'm saying? You know what I'm saying? I accolade myself for what's to come. You know what I'm saying? So, for me, it's like preparing for 1RC. I am in position just to kind of looking at the aspects of social media and what we can do. It's time for us to thrive. But at the same time, we need to look at organizations like Clubhouse and see which social networks we can go to ourselves. So, we have a social network called Celeb Island that we're working on. And we're working on that because that's literally on African servers. So this way, you know, our servers are, when we talk and when we doing everything we doing, it's not on the servers here. So when we talk about the diaspora, we are looking to go into our own apps. I don't have a problem with us going to Clubhouse and really building and branding that up, but I really want us to start putting our time and energy into the apps that we create, that we build, so that that way as we go into the 1.5 billion in the diasporas that we have, as well as in Africa and stuff, we have billions of people that can come to our network and don't have to worry about competing with everybody else, you know, wondering what's going on. Because what happens is we put all this content on everybody else's content, but they keep that content. So in 10 years from now, that content is relative on our network and we don't own it. We can't make NFTs off of it. We can't create anything off of it. So, you know, as we go, the thing is to utilize this year to work and get ourselves building as we put the infrastructure to get our apps and everything developed. And then as we start to do that, we start to move over to that. But, you know, working with Clubhouse and these organizations are, I think, a perfect opportunity now to really get the awareness out of what we need to do as if they're willing to work with us. Because we see, as economic developer, I don't have a problem working with Clubhouse, but we need to talk some business. If black people are going to come over here and we're going to be doing this and doing this, we need to be able to know what the shares are. So before we blow this up, we need to know what these shares are. We want to buy shares of it. So before we go there, the first thing we need to do is get black people acclimated on shares of Clubhouse. If they're public, if they're not public, how are we going to make money from taking this to another level? Because wherever we go, it's going to shift off. You know, that's why they created Black Planet, and it wasn't even black people that made Black Planet. You see what I'm saying? Everybody's quick to make our home and say, come here. You know, and so it's hard for us to have storefronts because everybody owns the storefront. And then what happens is when we go buy that storefront, we popularize it. And then what happens? They raise the rent on us. You kick us out. And now that we got so much traffic coming in, they take our concept and take our idea and run out. So I don't want to open up businesses unless we are the landlords for those companies. So with the property buyout that we're doing is buying the properties out so that we are now going to get landlords and training you to be landlords. So we have landlord training, and then we hire these business people that's coming in here so that now we are the landlords of all our small businesses. We cannot afford to do it any other way.
You're absolutely right. We certainly thank you tonight. And I want to thank all of our panel guests and our callers for joining us. This has been a phenomenal evening. And we certainly look forward to continue this conversation. And I do want we want you all to learn the and what is going on. We do have to build our own bottom line. We have to control our own. We have to do everything our own block in order to get full benefit of economically. So I want to thank you again, and if you would just share with us your final thoughts and wrap it up tonight for us, Marshon. Thank you.
I just want to say, as we move forward, we need to get the people to understand what Black is in their Bridge Dictionary, and it's brilliant. So if people want to, call us and recognize us by the Abridged Dictionary version of Black and call us brilliant. So when y'all post up all the stuff on y'all tube about the Black man, put brilliant man there. Use the Abridged Dictionary to recognize and talk about my people. If anything that needs to be said, that there is a new Black man coming to the forefront, it's too late to prepare for him because he's already here. Thank you.
All right, and thank you so very much. We appreciate you. Thank you all. Have a wonderful night. And stay safe. This is Dr. Mary Lee, and we'll see you next week. God bless you all. Good night, and I love you.
Peace to the ancestors. Yes. Peace to Dr. Cornell West. Yes. Peace to the movement. Yes.
We came from the bottom. Ever since they got us, we've been going through these problems. 400 years behind, and it's no promise that we gon' never actually be equal, to be honest. It's messed up how they put us in chains, kidnapped our language and changed our names. But when we speak Ebonics, then they call it a shame. They leave us with a couple options, rob or slang. Now we locked up a game. How much can our skin take? We went from slaves to inmates, carrying the weight of the 50 states. Working your farms, Black nannies carrying white babies in their arms. Black men sacrifice their lives in your wars, but you'll never show appreciation here at home. You treat us so damn wrong. You act like you hate my race. The police, they just beat us in the streets like an 808 base. America, when will you defend my case? It never will, cause your freedom is fake. I'm only living here cause I'm wanting to get paid enough to round up all my family and shake.
Get up, get up, get up, get up, get up, get up.
Might work till a couple of quirks. Can't call it pancakes cause you pour some syrup. It's a whole lot bigger than a pretty new house, especially when the rodent's still running about. P. Diddy running marathons, raising dough. That's going to the school where the tax money go. Homeland Security, now there's a phenomenon. Pacifying folks by hanging Saddam. Truth still riding, still obliging, still no Bin Laden.